Well, good afternoon. And
okay, folks, finally got out in the water as promised. All our live stream audience from wherever you are, welcome back for race five. It's the race five of the City Marine JJ Gilbert for 2014. And just heading down the start area, we've got Gary Whittaker's got the race committee down in Athol Bight, just opposite the zoo, famous Sydney Zoo. You can see the boats filming down there. This breeze is really patchy right now, and as Mark was saying, it's forecasted back down this afternoon. It was quite fresh this morning, 18 to 20 off the north head. So everybody, most of the boats are on second reefs, and probably wisely, but if this thing backs down as forecast, it should be able to pick up a lot of streaky breeze here, but they're pressured up with the two rigs. Even Murray was telling us how quick those second rigs are. If there's enough power for them, they are way faster than the big rig, just a lot more efficient. So just currently getting down. Mark, this race is going to be an interesting one because of the patchy air, and the old thing to remain is getting a lane off that start line is the first thing we've got to worry about, and then getting up that beat. There's a lot of holes in it. I reckon the wind will be swinging around a bit, so you've got to be in that first six around that top mark, or your day becomes very tough from that point.
Yeah, exactly right. I think particularly on a day when you might be short of horsepower at moments, when the lulls come in, particularly tricky if you don't have a great start. But I don't know. See, I think, and I'm sure I stand to be and probably will be corrected, I think the whole fleet have got this wrong. I think it's a big rig day today. I think they've all talked themselves into small rigs, partly because of what happened yesterday, when the people who went with big rigs were slightly disadvantaged, and partly because 7 won yesterday with a small rig. But we know that 7 are very keen to go small whenever they can. They've got such a good small rig, and as Ian Murray said, these small rigs work well in light airs. Well, some work better than others, would be my view. And 7's works particularly well because it's a very well-tuned, refined package. So I think the best news so far for everyone today is, gotta love it, 7 looking around and seeing all their oppo have somehow got themselves, I think, slightly suckered into going to small rig. Now, well, we'll talk to people after the race to see what's been going on, and maybe the small rig will come good. I could be miles offside myself, but I'm looking around the racetrack, I'm seeing more holes than I'm seeing gusts, and the usual adage when you're trying to choose a rig, it's like trying to choose a sail on a big boat and all that sort of thing, is you've got to set up the conditions you have at that point in time, because all we know for sure is the present tense. Everything else is a look into the future. So personally, I would have been going big rig and living with the odd puff and being deliriously happy every time I sailed into a lull. Yeah. But the rest of the fleet don't agree with me. Someone's right, someone's wrong.
Well, it's
we're going to see.
It's big rig right now, and I'm just looking at Kenwood Create More, our sponsor for today's race. Brett Van Munster, he's got the gonads out, and he read it as a big, so I reckon he could do some damage. He's just probably sitting there right now, licking his lips, thinking, oh, they've all gone twos, beautiful. We've got a shot at this, boys.
We think, so we know Brett's gone big rig. There's the AP going up just while the race committee gets themselves fully sorted. It's currently 5 to 3 local time. Race due to start in 5 minutes' time. AP goes up just because the race officer isn't 100% ready to start, bang on the official start time. But that doesn't mean we're going to have anything more than a very short delay. So don't worry too much about that. Yeah, I think big rigs, as far as I've seen so far, I think the Brits on the higher have got a big rig. Pika's got a big rig for sure. And Brett's got one, Brett Van Munster, on our day sponsor. That's Kenwood, Rabideaux and DeLonghi. It's all those three companies effectively are sponsoring today. The Rabideaux, by the way, is a local sports team. It's a rugby league team. Rugby league series is a big deal here in Australia. It's the most watched sport. I think I'm right. I mean, Warwick will correct me if I'm wrong in a second, being a real local, but I'm pretty sure it's the most watched sport in Australia. And the season starts today, actually, midweek start on a Thursday, and the Rabideaux, which is the South Sydney, one of the local clubs here in Sydney, they're actually playing tonight.
Yeah, and they're playing Eastern Suburbs, which is one of their tough... I think they won it last year, didn't they?
I think they used to did. It's a very full-on... Very full-on professional sport over here. It's called rugby league in England, for sure. Over here, it's usually called footy. It's their version of footy. It's the main sport, and most of the countries in the world won't even know what we're talking about, but it's a big deal in the rugby playing nations. But so that's the Rabbitohs, and the DeLonghi is over here, is sailed by Simon Nern, sponsored Simon Nern's boat, and Kenwood is the guys that sponsor Brett Van Munster's boat. So effectively our sponsor's got two boats in today's race, which would be nice for them.
Yeah, and I'm just watching Higher Appliances, Rick Peacock, Tristan Hutt and Rick Murray just sliding past very comfortable in their big rig with a shooter. Yeah, I think you're right, mate. This has gone really pasty out here now, and it's a big rig for sure.
Well, I think it is. I mean, I'm going to, although I'm not allowed to, I'm going to change my pick the podium. But I'm going to be still, I'm going to make life tough for myself. I'm going to go for all three big rig boats, which is unlikely it'll pan out that way, of course. But they're three decent boats. We know Brett Van Munster has won a race only a few weeks ago. There's nothing wrong with what he does. We know Rick Peacock, nothing wrong with the way he's sailing higher. And the third boat, Pika, well, they've looked pretty impressive all the way through. And so there you go. An outside shot for me, but I'm happy to go with it. Give me some decent odds on that, would you, Bob?
2-1, I reckon.
2-1 in a 34 boat fleet. Yeah, no, I said some decent odds.
I think it's a pretty good gig, to be honest. And I'd like to see it happen because it'll completely ruffle up the bloody leaderboard, won't it, Warwick?
Yeah, for sure. And I mean, that's what we've seen in this regatta, is that, you know, things can get mixed up a little bit. And just talking about the rig selection, you know, Seven's going to want to drag the rest of the fleet into their selection of second sailors. They know they're so strong. I was just having a quick chat to Chris Nicholson before we came out, and he said, you know, when it came down to a two-horse race and at the bottom mark the last time, that he just, you know, really sailed in a very high mode and high and slow mode, and he said he still couldn't outpoint them, you know, that they still just kept coming at them even though they were in disturbed air. I think one interesting thing is going to be is when we get to the top of this course, this short beat, first leg of the course, is the downwind part of it. If it gets really patchy down there, that's when the second rig could really hurt, and the guys with the big rig could make some big inroads. But as we've seen, that they've got to get up there cleanly. You can't be buried in 20th place and come through to the front. That's never going to happen.
Yeah, you're right, Waz. So I'll just give you the viewers the heads up on this race course, if they haven't been out here before in a southerly. We're down in Athol. So we come off this line, we go up to a turn mark, Port Hand rounding in the mouth of Double Bay, shoots on all the way down to Obelisk Bay, right down the north of the harbour on the northern side. Now that's a pretty tricky mark to get to because you've got to jibe into it. It's under the headland down there, so that's a good place to watch because there's plenty of overtaking lanes down there. And then you've got that long beat against the tide all the way back to Rose Bay. And then, so it's down here to the start mark again. So you've got two laps of that. It's a figure eight course. And yeah, it should be good. I'm looking forward to that.
Well, the fleet all just hanging out, waiting for the action. Well, a few boats have sailed the half of the first beat a couple of times just to get a feel for where the puffs are and what the kind of average headings are on both tacks. All the usual boat racing things going on here. A few boats I've seen checking out transits. Pretty easy transit to get today. There's a lighthouse and a couple bunch of trees just behind the pin end, so it'll make it pretty straightforward to sort out where the transits are. And looking both ways, the spectator boat, which is just to the right of your picture now, the big orange and red thing, is full and is on station. And as regular viewers will know, that the racing here on Sydney Harbour, the skiffs, does not start until the spectator boat is on station, which is a rather nice tradition. Looking after the punters who come out to watch, and some of which are having a bet, all of which are having a beer, and it's probably no bad thing. That's the way it should be. So we're in decent shape. There's plenty of breeze, not too shifty. I think there's every chance the race committee might be waiting for a ferry. They're quite critical here, Bob, isn't it, on ferry time and movements. He can't really start a race if it means his fleet's going to sail straight into an 18-knot Manly ferry.
Well, he's blindsided. Bradley's what's coming from Manly, so he's got to get on the radio and find out where they are and the timing of their arrival going across his start line. So yeah, that's been something that's been sorted out over the last few years. Where are those Manly ferries in relation to our sequence in getting these boats away? Could bugger up everybody's day, except for the people on the ferry. They'd enjoy it immensely, I'm sure.
Yep, we're planning to watch when that happens. Sydney Harbour Bridge. It's slightly in the gloom today. It's not really gloomy, but there's a little, this southerly has created a bit of a slightly humid, moist air day. Not the greatest of clearest of visibility, but the Harbour Bridge and the Opera House still doing the job for Sydney tourism, I have no doubt at all.
Hey, Mark. Get Warwick to give us his picks in case he's
Don't think for a second Warwick's getting off the hook. How did that happen? Oh, because we did our picks earlier on.
Yeah.
So I've changed mine already, Warwick, so I've kind of sort of negated the advantage that you might have. But what's your thoughts about today? Who's your top three? Who's going to do the business today?
Well, as we mentioned, you know, we've got a couple of quality boats. Three of the boats that have gone big rig, which seen has potential to win races. So that's going to be the big one. And just to answer your question, I'm going to put higher. I'll leave seven out of it, just to make it interesting. I'll go higher, Thurlow, and Mojo.
Higher, Thurlow, and Mojo. Interesting, there we go. One of the big rig boats is in there. We just heard the little siren. You might have heard that on the soundtrack. That was the AP flag coming down. So the next flag will be the class flag. It's a 5-minute gun coming up in about 30 seconds, a bit less than 30 seconds, I think. We'll get our watches set for on the next gun. We'll try and give you some kind of warning if we see them at the starters putting their little hands near to the flags. But coming up fairly soon. There's course four, the orange four, that's telling us which the course is. It's a fixed course, so there's no information about number of laps because course four is course four. There's no variation on that.
Hey, Mark, I'm just looking at the pin end, which is right up on Bradley's point, Bradley's head point, and gotta love it. Just went right down there for a nice little peek at that setup.
Sorry, Bob, there's a 5-minute gun, just people stop their watches. I'll give you countdown into the four, if anyone here might have missed that one. Sorry, Bob, you're saying the pin looks pretty close to the land down there, is that right?
Yeah, it is. You're clear Bradley's, which is good. You won't have to bounce off the bricks down there. You should be able to skate around the point, but so we've got to love it. It's right down there having a nice look at that, as is CST Howie Hamlin's CST composites.
Well, Bob, just on that, I was looking at it, you know, same time as you. I think it's got a bit of pin bias to it, and I think the majority of the fleet will want to be down that end and flop over pretty much as soon as they can. So, and here we've got a ferry which just coming around Bradley's now won't interfere with the start with 3 minutes to go. But I call a general recall. That's what I'm seeing will line up here.
I got a feeling that's a spot on call. I was going to say the same as I'm seeing exactly the same way as you were. I see the pit is the place to be, and I got a feeling at least 30 of the 34 competitors will think the same. That wasn't a very good count into the 4-minute gun, was it, for you all? But there was the 4-minute gun. So we're getting close to race time. As you said, it could be a general. Could easily be a general recall. There's going to be a lot of action down at the end of the line.
It's really getting light, isn't it?
It's softening. I mean, looking up the race course now, and let's imagine we are racing ourselves in this race. Looking up the race course, looks like possibly more breeze to the right, but puffy, lots of holes. Nice, I can see some soft bits and some breezy bits. In the middle, it looks, well, the same, but lighter, and left, maybe it looks a little firmer. I'm seeing a few less lulls on the left-hand side at the moment, Warwick. I don't know what your eyes are telling you. I guess on the averages, I'd be middle left, forgetting about line bias, just in terms of where the best pressure is. But I'm remembering the last time we did this race course, people who went left got nailed. 2 days ago, I nailed as in did badly. The ones who went left on this, what is a very short beat, it'll be less than 10-minute sailing. All the good news, all the good winners came from the middle and the hard right.
We've got two factors here. I mean, and just going back to your question, you got more runway to the land a little bit further over to the left. So just being that a factor, you'd imagine the breeze is going to build up a bit more, got more time. But also you got tide. So I think they're going to, you know, want to flop over and get into that tide as soon as they can, outgoing tide here, which is going to give them a bit of an elevator.
So what we're kind of saying is we think you'd want to start on the left but get over to the right, so ideally tack early. Yeah, if there's enough bias, you know, if there's enough left hand, and it'd be quite easy to attack and to clear the starboard tackers. It's got a love at seven, having a good look. I'm sure they're having an interesting dialogue on board about the same kind of thing. Ian Murray talked about the fact that they want to have a much better start than they did yesterday. They kind of got themselves in a world of trouble and then got themselves out of a world of trouble too, but there's not as much wind today. It's not this, we don't have the same big northeasterly race courses. A much tighter race track. If you get this first beat wrong, like they really did initially yesterday, there's not enough runway to make a recovery, is the Warwick. I mean, I think a bad start today from seven, and they might not get through.
Well, they're certainly not going to, if they have a bad start, they're not going to get through by the time they get to the first mark. So, as you said, the beat is probably a third of the distance of what we had yesterday, so it's just time. They haven't got the time.
And a moment, just following on from Warwick's comment, look at the whole fleet. There they are, and guess where they are? They're already heading down towards the left end of the line. We've got about 1 minute 40 seconds to go. We'll try and get that 1 minute gun nice and accurate for you. So already everyone's making their intentions clear. I've got a feeling the race officer may as well get the general recall flag in his hand early. He won't black flag next time. Did it be that punchy to go straight to a black? I mean, at the moment, the issue, I think, is it's two left bias. That's the start line that's wrong. It's not the sailors. If you make the line heavily left bias, well, guess what's going to happen? That's not the sailors' issue. They'd be crazy to start anywhere else. Unless the wind is shifty, of course. But at the moment, it all looks good on the left, doesn't it? There's about 5 seconds to go. Let's count ourselves into this one.
Certainly set up really high, didn't he?
3 seconds to go. Set your watches. The 1 minute gun coming up. There you go. 1 minute to the start of race 5 of the 2014 JJ Giltinan Championships, brought to you by Sydney City Marine, support sponsored Winning Appliances, and today's sponsor is Kenwood DeLonghi Rabbitohs. And thanks again to Sailing Anarchy for helping us with our live stream. So here we go, not too long at all, 35 seconds. There's a lot of action down the left end of the line, a lot of people practicing slow motion yachting, trying to do that really difficult skill we've discussed, which is try and stay stationary, try not to move too much. Got a lot of seven in a really nice position, albeit early. Couple of boats over already. Several, sea deck we can see semi-capsized, hoping this race doesn't, it's got to be a general. I can already can't see the pin end of the line. We're beautifully positioned. Peter's filming straight down the line. I'm not sure if any of you at home can see the pin end, but I certainly can't. No chance of this being a start. This has got general written all over it. We can set ourselves up for the next start. Here we go, into the gun. Well, it'd have been easier to counter the number of boats that weren't over the line, that's for sure, and I'm not sure you'd have counted very many. So I think that's a clear indication from the fleet that the race officer needs to do something about that pin, is all I can say. I mean, look at this, look at the boats on starboard, Panasonic and Viagogo, that's Alex South's boat, barely laying, not doing much better than laying the line on starboard. So that tells you what you need to know. We need to move the line. So
yeah, but if he drops it back to make it less biased, he's going to have there's no runway down there. All those pin boats sort of hit the bricks.
No, yeah, just move the committee boat forwards is the best geometry solution. Anchor up, move forward 100 metres or probably 50 metres, drop it down. We'll see. It might have been a particularly left phase shift at the time, but I'm still looking at the boats going up there. There's a little bit more of a righty as they lift their way up. Remember, this is not a natural start. There has been a general recall. These boats are all going to have to come back quite soon, but they're all giving themselves a chance at a little practice beat, get a feel for the wind, feel for the wind pressure, check their settings, check the boat speed. They won't want to go too far in this direction. They know that our race committee is not shy to bang off a second race pretty damn quickly.
No, that's right, they want to get into it. And Kilo, just a question for you, how far can the committee boat move out from where they are now before they infringe their license?
I would
license?
Think they can come up 50 metres, they're not in the ferry line at that point. He's trying to do his best to keep out of the ferry area, but I think he's still pretty safe. If he just pops that up 50 metres, it'll give him a lot of leverage, particularly for the fleet to get a decent start.
So just stay here with me. So Peter, we're just going to show people what we're talking about here. So there's the committee boat. Peter's giving you a little scan. He's going to pick you up with now we can see the pin at last, without all the boats. That was the pin that's been hiding. And if you keep coming around here, Peter, let's just talk to people about what's going on. So here's our line, but our issue, if you look around to the right here, Peter, is that to my left, to the right of the camera picture, as you're about to pick me up in picture, to the right over there is Sydney Harbour Bridge, and over there is a place called Circular Quay. Now, that Circular Quay, that is where, of course, all the major shipping movements, well, the ferries come from. And they come from there, they go across our line here, round the corner that these guys are racing around to Manly. And that's a bit like, it's like the number 10 bus. These things go every 20 minutes on the 20 minutes, and they do 18 knots, Warwick, don't stop for anyone. And, there's a green one there, let's look at one there. There is exactly what we're talking about. So that, they have priority. Commercial shipping has priority in Sydney Harbour, even though we've got a very famous regatta going on here. That's ship has priority, and at 80 knots you don't want to argue with him. So you, if you start the race much closer up towards that shipping lane than we are now, well, we're just going to be in all sorts of trouble with the maritime authorities. So the race officer is very sensitive to that issue. We have a good relationship with commercial shipping here. He's very sensitive to it. I agree with you, Warwick, he needs to go up that way, but he goes much more than 50 metres and the phone's going to be ringing.
Yeah, but 50 metres will be enough to sort this out, to take a bit of the compression off of the pin end. But he doesn't look like he's pulling the anchor up, and so, I don't know, he's just going to hope that they get off. But, you know, if he goes into a black flag scenario with that amount of compression down the pin end, we're going to have the same situation we had the other day, where for sure boats will be carted off the course, told to go home.
Yeah, they will for sure. I mean, it's a tough way to do it. He's allowed to do it. There's no, I mean, he won't be a very popular man if he black flags a start where you can barely cross it on starboard. It's happened before, it wouldn't be the first time.
Yeah, and the thing is too, because I think the black flag actually caught a few people out the other day, because it's not something that he does on a regular basis. It's not something, you know, that they're used to seeing. And so we commented on the start that day that a lot of those guys that are three deep or down the pin would have no way of seeing the black flag was up. They don't have radio comms on the boat, so they can't be notified that way.
Good point.
So it's a tough one. It's something that I think they'll be more mindful of, as you know, during this regatta now.
Yeah, I totally agree with you. So here's Jared Simpson on the black dog coming towards us in the red coloured.
Johnny Sweeney.
Give me a little smile. John Sweet in the middle. Mr. Versatile himself doing a nice job with Jared, having a little look around. Jared's definitely got a good performance or two in him, that's for sure. He's served at the right end of a very hot UK International 14 fleet a number of years ago. Been a skiff sailor for quite a while. Got a good boat. The boat doesn't do too many hours, it's almost a new boat, it gets used so little. So we haven't really seen him on fire yet this series, but that could happen. But another boat's gone small rig. And no question, just
so
back to that rig.
That pin down, Mark.
Ah, you're right, Warwick.
That's
he's done two things, hasn't he? Well, you're absolutely right. Yeah, I can see three problems, but I'm going to let you go first on them and see if I can add one to your list.
Well, the thing is, you know, he's done the right thing by trying to get the bias right by moving the pin back, but because of the geography, it's going to create another set of problems, and it's actually shorter now because of the way the land lies, but they're going to be running into a brick wall. You know, the guy starting at the pin will run into a brick wall 15 seconds after this race has started, so then you're going to have, the whole ducking the fleet situation, the traffic jam. So very tricky with the shipping lanes and the geography to create what we would normally see as a fair start line or an even course.
Yeah, I agree. He's got a tough job. I don't feel it's unfair. I mean, I think you're right. It's tough to make it really fair, but it's degrees of fairness. I'd say this is a demanding start for a world championship fleet of world-class sailors, and that's how it should be. Shouldn't be too easy, but there's nothing easy about this one. As Warwick pointed out, there's three issues here. The problem one, it's a much shorter line. It's significantly shorter, and that's like 20% shorter than it was before. It didn't look very big previously. And also, as Warwick said, look at the terra firma just behind the pin. So what is going to happen? People are going to go in there on starboard. They're going to start calling for water early, because that's what you always do. But there gets a point at which you just have to tack, or as you'll hit something, the boats inside have to give you room to tack and complete, but don't have to give you any more than that.
You're going to have to
therein lies the real issue of the rule. Yeah. That's the one. That's the question is, could a boat have tacked and ducked? Nobody wants to tack and duck, but could they do it if you're a little bit crunchy, if you're maybe a couple back from the pin and you sail high and slow on starboard? That's what I'd do, Warwick. I'd go in there and I wouldn't be giving anyone any water until they were literally touching the land.
It's a black flag start.
And you're dead right there. That's where it gets contentious. You know, have you got enough room to duck? But then you've got the compression of the fleet, because everyone's got to give everybody room. It goes down the line.
Absolutely. And Bob just pointed out, this is going to be black flag. So this is quite edgy. I quite like this, but it adds a bit of frisson to the fleet. What? It's only the second start. It's not like we've been out here for an hour or two. On only the second start, Gary has told us he's going to go black flag. So that's the 5-minute gun. That's the class flag that's gone up. But the next flag is going to be the 4-minute, and we've got a very strong suspicion it's going to be a black flag.
Well, you're going to have to buy a ticket to get on the front row, Mark. That's for sure and certain. There's not enough room for 34 boats there in a black flag start. So I'll be selling tickets or trying to buy one to get on the front line, because they're not all going to live there.
I think you're right, Bob. Which end of the line do you think we should position on? Are you thinking you might trickle down to the pin? Do you like your spot here? What do you think? I'm just throwing it out there. I know it's tight for us down there, but it's tight for everyone. I've got a feeling there's plenty going to be going on those rocks.
There's going to be a lot of boats wheeling around. I don't know.
I'll leave that with you.
Yeah, no.
I don't have to do the job.
It'll look good.
It will look good, that's for sure. It's going to be exciting. It's such a short line, we should be able to see things pretty well from here. See what goes on. As Bob said, you'll want to get to this line pretty early.
And buy a ticket. There she goes, the big black.
Black flag.
But I think the rule is, if they're over, I think the rule is with the black flag, if they're over with a minute to go, that's it, they're done.
Absolutely right. Michael Coxon is over the line as our seven right now, as is Harry Hannon. That's okay. You're okay now, but you're not okay at 1 minute. That's effectively, and then onwards, you're in trouble. Now keep a really close eye on the timing here. So we've had the 4 minute gun, we're at about 3:30. You've got to get early, but you've got to kind of calculate your rate of drift, if that's the right expression, because you need to really stop sailing, as Warwick's talked about how hard it is to be stationary in these boats, but genuinely stationary as opposed to drifting sideways and backwards and getting yourself in irons. Keeping control and being stationary, really delicate skills required to make that happen.
Well, Sammy's pulled his gear on down there, and you can see he's just going straight into the bricks.
He's having a little look, isn't he? He's checking it out, coming up to 3 minutes to go. There's a 3 minutes. I've got a feeling that God Love at Seven will be just saying the word conservative to themselves. Keep it safe. Series leader with 3 bullets, but a bad result on the scorecard at a 12. Don't want a black flag now. Don't want to get flicked out. I think they're going to have to rely on their boat speed. And I think Sevi's saying right now, or probably Scott's doing the talking on this one, saying
calm down, anything
even close to the top 10 at the first mark is an absolute great result. Not interested in trying to win this one at all. We'll just got a lot of racetrack to make it up. Even 15. No problem, but let's not go black flag, lads. And I'm sure everyone's saying that to a lesser or great extent, particularly the series leader.
Yeah, well, they've got the luxury of speed. When you've got confidence in your speed, you can take that approach. When the guys are maybe scrappling out and haven't quite got that speed, they're going to put things more on the edge, aren't they?
So you're absolutely right, Warren. Coming up to 2 minutes. Oh, I can feel, you can almost feel the heart rate's gone up with all the crews. That black flag changes the atmosphere. All of a sudden, everybody's milling around, bit of a nice day out, see what happens, lads. Suddenly, black flag, hang on, this is serious. This is serious. For a lot of people, this is make or break time for their 2014 JJ Giltinan. People, the boat's spreading out. All of a sudden, a lot more interest in the right end of the line. That's interesting, isn't it? Even though the bias is still left, you still want to be hard left if you could, all things being equal. At the moment, I'm seeing a lot of interest in the middle and the right of the line. I'm seeing seven coming back this way, seven tacking now in what is the middle of the line. They'll probably end up to the left by the time we get to the start gun. At about 1 minute, 30 seconds to go.
Van Munsen wants the boat with his big rig.
Yeah, I won't even ask you, Warwick, who you think's going to be down the pin. You know who that's going to be, don't you?
Yeah, old mates in the kitchen maker.
Oh yeah, kitchen maker just doing circles down there, round and round and round, just saying, hey guys, we own this spot. Anyone who wants to have a look, by the way, this is our piece of real estate. You'll have to fight us for it. Peak are nicely positioned. That's one of our big rig boats. They're nicely set up, safely inside the ley line for the pin end.
And it looks quite soft on track.
And it looks soft. I think they're rubbing their hands on the fact they look up and see a big sail. 1 minute gun. There it goes. As the black flag goes down, that gives you 1 minute to go. Wow, race officer's got a lot on here. He's got to get, this is big decisions for race officer. This is where the race officer plays a massive part in the result of regatta. He's got to spot who, if anyone, is black flag. Write them down quickly, and there's a lot of them. You better write down fast.
I'm just thinking, where's Hayer Appliances? They're just going to take a very relaxed position off this start line. They're going to be on the boat.
Oh, yeah. A lot of screaming and shouting. Don't get forced over now. Yandu. John Winning's Yandu, awfully close to the line in the middle. He needs to sail to the top of the compass forks pretty quickly before he gets forced over the line. Seven looking quite nicely set up, fairly conservative. But this end of the line, 20 seconds to go. Panasonic Lumix, very vulnerable, looking exposed. They need to stop the boat and sail backwards, otherwise they're going to be over early. There's no coming back from a black flag, remember. Over is over, you're out of the day. Less than 10 seconds to go. Look at the pin end. Asco there, terribly early. That's brave sailing. 3 seconds to go. 2, 1. Here comes the start. They're too early. Chris Nicholson's mojo absolutely nails that pin. I think that everybody was clean. Nobody over there, no black flags. The black flag did the business. Chris Nicholson completely nailed the pin. Pico couple back looked pretty good.
Brett Van Munsen's tangled up with Winning Appliances here.
That's horrible. That's a horrible shape. So one of our big rig boats, Kenwood, Crate Moore, in trouble.
Hire tax off, Mark.
Hire tax off at the unbiased end of the line for hire, but maybe they're just thinking, let's go clean air, let's get our big rig working, off we go. In comes the mainsail, and she's off and running. Well, that'll be an indication of the performance of a big rig, because Hire certainly not leading on the water right now by any means. So slow off the line, let's see what she looks like by the top mark. Yeah, absolutely right. We're spotting the ASCO boat behind the whole fleet. They had an infringement down the pin end of the line. They got there too early, had to bail out of the left end. On their way back, fouled someone.
Great start, Mojo, though. Wasn't it?
Mojo, absolutely. Then it got a love at seven, looking very good middle left as well. They found themselves a lane, lifting up inside some other boats. Lots of room, a little righty actually coming in there. And the boats that weren't hard on the pin, looking good. I mean, Chris Nicholson won the pin, no question about that. But unfortunately for him, the breeze has lifted just after Bradley's. And he won't be very pleased about that. He's got to find something to come back on. I'm just wondering whether, like a few days ago when we raced this course, whether the guys on the right is where all the leaders will come from.
Well, it could be, but at the moment, from what I've seen, all the guys that have gone right at the moment are the guys that got spat out there. They, you know, they had really no choice. They had bad starts or in dirty air. So for me, the guys that got off the line clean and are still going left, but you're dead right in that we've got a little bit of a right shift in the middle that the guys at the very left didn't get. So that's really hurt Nico and Mojo.
The boats, the middle left boats, well, the two of those were Michael Cox and Thurlow Fisher, just to windward and just clicked inside, got a love at seven and got a love at seven. They're the two boats looking particularly good on the middle left at the moment. Chris Nicholson, hard left moment. He's not going to want to tack back on that shift. Pika's down there as well. I can just see her trickling through a few boats, using that big rig to advantage. But again, she's looking a bit exposed on the left-hand side. Have to see what happens. This is a short beat, as we said. It's only a 10 minutes from start to rounding over on this side of the fleet. Well, about a third of our fleet are over here. A lot more room, a lot more lanes. Feels like more pressure as well. Just eyeballing, doing an eyeball comparison. Looks like a little bit more wind on this side of the racetrack.
Just interested in Hire. Peter, if you come around to the right, he's got Panasonic Lumix on a second rig, but he went right back towards the Sydney Harbour, the Opera House, and he's just clocked into this.
What's going on?
I think Lumix is getting told to go home. She's the boat we said were looking very early. They looked over the line possibly with a minute to go, didn't they, Warren?
Yeah.
We said they better sail backwards. They knew they were exposed. John O'Whitty knew he was pushing it.
You can see the body language.
Yeah, they're not racing. They've stopped.
That's it.
So there was one black flag, or at least one. There's one gone so far. Let's see if they go and try and find anyone else. Just let Rag and Famish on a small rig today. They were a big rig boat yesterday. I think Jack McCartney might be regretting that decision. And whilst these boats are over here, I've just seen the boats over on the other side of the race course. Got a love at seven in an even bigger lift. Massive right-hand rotation.
Two different ways of getting up here, eh?
Wow. That's the issue, is how do they get out of the corner? Michael Coxon came back this way to try and get away from that shift, but all that's happened is he's now just pointing to get the transom of seven. Such a big right-hander. Well, seven eventually decided they have to tack. Oh, my word, seven, awful tack. Almost capsized the boat. Not sure if Peter could get that far away. I know he had the camera pointing in the right direction, but that was a shocking tack. Not sure what happened there. Got themselves in a real kerfuffle.
Clients is online, and Thurlow Fisher on a nice little righty here.
Well, the righty that we saw seven was on. Well, seven's coming back bow down, having the opposite side of that lovely lift. Well, now Michael Coxon has taken the benefit of, he took his pain early, and now he's coming back looking a lot better. Clients is online also, much better performance than them yesterday. Bob, you talked about them yesterday suddenly performing, and here they are, benefit of this righty. It's a persistent right all the way into Double Bay. It has indeed. Being on the right is very good news here, but got a love at seven is having to duck these two leaders. Remember, it's a port rounding. We're very close to the windward mark. It's about 100 metres away from where we are now. Going to try and get up to windward of these guys. It's going to be tricky to get a path through. Bob doing his best to slice us through. Oh, it was a little opening for us here, I think, Bob, wasn't it? A little opening behind Mojo, ahead of DeLonghi. Good work. Good work, Bob. Beautiful work from our driver.
I have my eyes closed.
Okay, so this is going to be tight. This is going to be really tight, the top mark. They're all coming to the mark, but on port tack. Can we get down there, Bob?
Yeah, port hand round it, yeah.
We're going to get down there as soon as we can, show you this nice and close.
Finding it in.
Got a level 7 tax on to starboard, but you can't get to Plancers online. What about Mojo? What can Chris Nicholson do here? Oh, he's got a duck. He's got to do a horrific duck. He just couldn't get through that gap between Plancers and got a level 7. Can got a level 7 lay? This is going to be really tough for them. Slow sailing, and they're going to bounce the boat around the buoy. Big heel, lads. Just about did enough to get it round. Didn't drag the buoy, so that's legal. And now what happens is you bear away on starboard into a wall of port tackers. Woof, this is tricky sailing. Mojo in the end, getting around in third. Plants online, go early kite. Got a level 7, goes to the kite as well. It's pretty hectic down here. This is classic port starboard. An awful lot of boats struggling to find the holes to get through.
Look at how he's to this mark.
Oh, he's reaching over the top. He's got to find his gap. Look at that. Where's the gap going to come, Harry? Oof, I hope he finds one soon. Yeah, he's found one. He's weaved his way through. There's actually quite a big gap by the mark. I reckon Harry could just tack on the mark here. There's a huge gap. Harry can, if Harry spots that, he can tack right there and go inside everyone. Harry Hamlin, the wily old dog, he sees the gap. And Harry Hamlin, nice work. A little gap being created by all these boats, and he just slips round.
And they've all done a kilo.
They've all gone the early hoist with a kilo.
I like what the Plancers did. Didn't make around straight into
it. Here comes Team High. Here comes Team Pika with a big rig. Not doing as well as I thought they'd do there. We'll see them in a second, but it's organised chaos, Warwick, is what I'd describe this mark rounding.
Yeah, I don't know how organised it is, but it's certainly chaos. No, it's tough in that mid-fleet, isn't it?
Seemed to be, but the best boat somehow wriggled through. It was shifty as you like up there, somehow or other. Got a level 7, and Mojo, and Appliances Online, just got themselves through all the carnage, didn't they? Despite the fact there was shifts all over the place.
Well, yeah, the hard right didn't work off that beat because there's right damage.
And higher as well were out there, didn't work, you're right. The left worked despite the fact there was a big persistent righty. The persistent righty didn't seem to extend to the right-hand side of the course, Warwick. It was localised.
Yeah, well, I mean, as we were talking about it, the guys that went right early were the guys who were forced to do that, spat off. So, you know, just pulled smart money, continued left for a fair while.
Well, we're going to hack down here and see what we can, who we can catch up with. This is a jive in there. I've seen Gottlob at 7 rolling into a jive. First of our leaders to jive. Normally, this is the kind of leg where you can barely lay in one. You have to drop your kite, but the breeze is a lot more round to the right. It's much more lifted today. So this leg is becoming a really interesting tactical jiving run.
Mark, a nice little obstacle coming straight at the fleet. There's a big inbound tanker coming straight up the harbour right now.
Oh, nice spot.
Gottlob at 7 saw it, and they're going to lure it of it already. They're setting up down smart. You wouldn't want to get pinned out on the windward side of that.
There's a pilot boat out the front of it, creating an exclusion zone, which is good. So the fleet are having to decide about where we are now, is where as a skiff you'll decide which side you want to go of this moving chicane.
Yeah, and I just watched after 7 jibes take a step down. Appliances kind of responded and did the same, but they didn't get it without pressure and got really hurt. Up the fleet now, I think Mojo has actually extended. They've continued to electors can continue on, and I think they've made gains on that.
Yeah, I think Mojo and Fellow Fisher got a bit of a letdown, didn't they? As the 7 jibed away, there's a bit of a knock. The two of them are just going to roll over the front of 7's bow.
Now Mojo goes into a jibe. They have to get, got to get distance between themselves and this big ship, because they're not getting above the ship, not getting to weather of it. So they've got to get themselves down on the shore there to try and get some distance so they don't just sit there becalmed.
Yeah, that's just what third official Mojo just jived away. That's just you said that. But I always wonder if they consider going to windward there for a second, Warwick. You think that was an option?
Yeah, well, I think it is. And they've got a Manly Ferry coming straight at them as well. So double whammy here. Could change the fortunes of a few boats.
Well, the leading boat that's going to the windward is Simon Nairn's DeLonghi. That's our day's sponsor today. They'll be excited by that. So actually on the water, if you're running a tracker at the moment, boat closest to the mark is Simon Nairn's DeLonghi, probably followed by 7, then Mojo, then Thurlow Fisher, but these boats are all taking radically different paths to the target.
The one boat that's done really well was ASCO. We remember that we commented that ASCO were doing turns from a penalty at the start, so they've come back from that to, you know, maybe 6th place and being able to get above this ship, so that's going to help them also.
Yeah, you're right, that's a great recovery, isn't it? They were basically last off the start line, but done pretty nicely since. Right, there's the big ship, there's the good ship ASCO just in our sights here. Now they've got a lot of, they need a decent letdown to get down to the mark we're trying to get to, but a lot's going to happen between now and where we're aiming for, and not a bad place for the good ship Asco to beat. There's Marcus Ashley Jones cruising along.
And another ferry. Another fast ferry coming in the same lineup, so she's a triple whammy. And the Navy training vessel coming into the game as well.
Ferry central, isn't it? Commercial traffic central, it's all happening here. There's Asco and DeLonghi very bow up at the moment. Maybe they'll find a bit of what Seven found up in Watson's Bay. Maybe it was it 3 days ago, Warwick, on that light airs day, where it all came quite good in right tight in Watson's Bay.
And also too, we think of yesterday, the Navy, they're not going to change course, they're not going to slow down. They reckon they own this joint, so the ferries we saw actually giving them a bit of room and slowing down a bit, where the Navy was just charging on through, so that could be interesting.
Yeah, Peter's got you nicely cameraed on that Navy boat there. It is a fearsome sight. Here goes, Cape Horn coming through here now. Wow. Now, of the three boats to leeward, so there's the Navy training boat. He's not going to give up now. Down to the left, down to the leeward side, here's the leading pack. Our leading pack of leeward boats. It's Gotta Love It Seven, who's just a click in front of Mojo. Another boat length in front of Furlough Fisher, and Appliance is online, nicely hovering just off their hip. These four pretty tight, pretty close together. They've got quite a lot of separation on any other boats down on this low lane. The whole of the rest of the fleet is in what's become the high lane, separated by that large tanker. Another good day by Appliance online, Bob. You like the look of them yesterday, they're doing it again.
Yep. Zooming along there, and Mojo's giving Seven some hurry up. Sevy's trying to stay low, I think. He's not interested in going too high. He knows the marks now, but he doesn't want to let Mojo roll him.
I think Chris Nicholson did exactly the right thing, just asking a few questions here at Seven, giving them a reason to put the bow up and defend, putting them off their game. The last thing he wants is Seven getting in their stride and legging it off into the horizon. I'd say Chris Nichols has got an edge of speed here, Warwick. He's coming into Seven here.
Yeah, well, I think, you know, the Mojo team's probably a little bit lighter than the Seven team. So we're in this sort of downrange second sail. That's going to help them, isn't it, downwind?
Yeah, you're absolutely. And look how high wiring Seven is. Yeah, Seven are having to put the wires on the super high setting to stay on the wire. And traffic. Here comes some traffic.
Exactly. I mean, if Nico, I'm sure he will elect to go above this cruising boat.
Oh, Seven's got an issue. He's not. I mean, luckily, Seven are going to have to drive away here, I think. Yeah, they are going to choose to drive. Oh, no, Scott goes in and doesn't drive. That was too risky to separate. Bust through, but that's enough. Mojo rolls. Nice work. Chris Nicholson taking his opportunity. Well, now, can we get a little closer here, Bob, and see quite what's going on?
I know
I'm asking unreasonable questions of you, but it's pretty interesting. Actually, Mojo bust through in the end. Seven, just for a second, I thought we were going to go for the massive
look at
last.
Asco and DeLonghi.
Oh, it's all happening, isn't it? So our little group, on our little group here, Mojo have overtaken Seven. You don't often say that, do you?
No, proper overtake.
But as you said, up front, the high lane boats, DeLonghi and Asco, they've found a bit of breeze. They're getting their bows down. DeLonghi right now is doing like two or three knots quicker. They've got more wind. Yeah. But they've all got to jive, even the low lane boats. We've all got to jive for this leg. It is a VMG run from now onwards.
I've got DeLonghi leading now, just from my guesstimates.
I would agree on the shift he's on now. I mean, having said that, he's got a big bow down, which is what's making him look good. He's got to find an angle to jibe on. He's going to want...
That's a pressure down.
Yeah, it is a pressure down. You're absolutely right, it is. So that should stay the same on the other way out on the other side. He's just fast, isn't he? Look great.
Now they're all of the same.
Now Mojo takes off as the breeze comes in. Sydney Marine, we said it's about time we saw something from them. Well, David responding. Great performance from him. He's rolled down from that high lane. He's found some pressure, and he's flat chat too. Mojo flying, Mojo with, as Warwick said, a slightly lighter crew, using to advantage. Previously it helped him roll into Seven, now he's going bow down on Seven with that lovely lighter crew in a big, nice puff, flat water. You don't need a heavy crew right now, actually the lighter crew the better.
First two boats are in front of the bow of the camera gate.
There we go. There's our leader, Simon Nerns DeLonghi, crosses our bow. He's still a couple of minutes and some challenging boat handling from making this rounding. Round to the left even further, Peter. Sorry, didn't give you a very good steer on that one. There is the leader. Has just crossed us. Has just crossed all the rest of the fleet. And there's two cruising boats down here. I'm afraid for Simon Nern, just as he hoped he was going to have a simple life, I've got two very slow cruisers, both going around the same mark. Wow, this is like Cows Week or one of those sort of more social racing weeks.
Glasgow's really got a hot angle coming.
Simon Nairn Jide is all about DeLonghi at this point in time. Simon's got to make some good decisions now. Going to roll to windward of this cruiser. Yep. Roll to windward. Yeah, don't go to leeward of that one, Simon. And he's going to have a pretty deep. He hasn't chosen the best lay line there, but to be fair to him, that cruiser did not make his life easy. Simon now pointing at the bottom mark. He's deeper than he wants to be, but he's going to come in on one. He's clear ahead of the rest of the fleet. Rest of the fleet approaching on the opposite jibe. I think Chris Nicholson's going to be second round. DeLonghi goes round, drops the spinnaker and goes round first. So Rabideau's DeLonghi, Rabideau's the co-sponsor opening the rugby league season tonight here in Sydney. Fantastic day to perform. Great work. First round, Simon Nairn. Now a cruising boat getting in the way of Mojo Wines. Luckily, giving Chris Nicholson a bit of room. Great boat handling if he can pull it off. Great job by Chris Nicholson. No, come on, Chris. Keep her upright. Get the weight up. Get the cruiser out of the way. Ah. Oh. Great recovery, Chris Nicholson.
Yeah, they all come down.
Now the cruiser
has jammed it out.
The cruising boat has parked himself up on the mark. What is he thinking? Really, more common sense surely would have got him out of the way. Asco pile in. Seve touching the other boat. That's not ideal to do that, but to be fair, it looked like Asco fouled him. We'll have to look at that one later on. Let's see if anyone does any turns. There's a lot of chat going on. In the end, if Lance is online, go round in fifth. Sixth, Sydney City is our series sponsor, Sydney City Marine. And then it's Smeg, and then CST, Kitchen Maker. And finally, we see Michael Cox on Furlough Fisher. Don't know what happened to him, Warwick. Did you keep an eye on that?
He was in the low lane with chasing that low pack.
Well, absolutely right. So I'm not seeing any turns being done on the Asco coming together with seven.
I might have got that right.
Well, there was definitely contact. I saw the two boats attached to each other. Well, the film will show the story, of course. If indeed it goes to that, maybe they'll just stay friends and walk away from the protest, and we'll have to see. In the meantime, the race carries on. Unfortunately, more cruisers wanting to have a crack at this mark. You'd think they'd just go round wide, wouldn't you, really, on a booze cruise day? Anyway, what do we know? Here comes Pika, our other big rig boat, a long way back. We're going to see if her extra horsepower, now there's more space down here, if that can help her. Round she goes. Oh, it's busy down here, isn't it? I think, as you say often, Bob, you wouldn't want to be in the middle of this fleet because it's damn crowded and pretty ugly.
How's the air? It's just fourth hand down here.
Well, yeah, and it's like, it's, you know, okay. I think they're professional skippers on these boats. I mean, they're charter boats. I mean, most of the guys have tried to do their best, but it's a tricky one, isn't it? You know, we don't own the harbour. This fleet doesn't own the harbour, but I think people would understand the stature of this event.
Time on distance, maybe, Warwick?
Yeah, I think it's a fair comment, Warwick. We don't own it, so we've got to share the love of this sensational harbour. But every now and then, you kind of hope that people would maybe use a couple more common sense pills. That's probably what, we'll leave it there.
SeaTac's way back, and Yamaha is similarly back.
Brett, I'm Brett Van Munster, yeah. So just to recap, that really changed around there in the last sector of that run, didn't it, guys? It's like the DeLonghi came out of nowhere, and the thing was, when that ship was coming down, and I was looking at, you know, Nico and Thurlow and Seven, that they were bowed down. They weren't going to get above that ship anyway. So that sort of dictated where they went. Oh, crash down here.
Well, the Germans were calling for water so aggressively they forgot about where the boy was. And in the end, they've hooked up with the Winning of Plants' boat. That's not John Winning, that's the Queensland version. The two of them are attached, I think. But the Germans have hooked the mark as well. So we've got like a three-boat pile-up. I think at least one of them is attached to the mark and two of them attached to each other.
Timer it.
Oh, yeah, they've freed themselves to the mark. It's like a carry-on film from the 1970s, isn't it? It's like yachting, only completely different. Anyway, we'll leave the chaos back here, get up to the more commercial end of the fleet and see how those guys are going. Yeah, I think you're right. Chris Nicholson deciding it's about time he used his class and his experience, and he's putting it all together at the moment. But also, nice work by Simon Nairn's DeLonghi, still keeping it together as well. A good lead for him at the top mark. See if he's got the mental strength to keep it together for at least a few more legs, and maybe he goes the whole way. Maybe claims a win for the day sponsor. That'd be nice for him. Nice for the Rabideaus, nice for Kenwood, nice for DeLonghi, that's for sure. Let's see how he does.
The breeze is a bit more solid down here, Mark, don't you reckon?
Yeah, you're absolutely right. There's a little bit more breeze. I think right now, no problem with a small rig. I don't think the big rigs are in too much trouble, but I think the small rigs will be working just fine. That usually means God will love at 7, begin their march to the front. Let's see how it pans out today. As you said, Warwick, Chris Nicholson looking extremely focused.
And this breeze has coughed to the left a bit. I think it's more in the gone east and south. The rain a lot higher than what they would have been in southerly, mate. I think this breeze is coughing left.
Yeah, it really seems that that big liner, the tanker rather, that came through halfway through that run that split the fleet in two. Well, as it turned out, most of the back markers took the high lane. They could see what happened. The high lane was definitely the advantage place to be. That's where our leader, Simon Nern, came from, where Sydney Marine came from, where ASCO came from. And most people just followed them with, you know, they could see what was going on and caught and ran themselves into the fleets while the whole fleet compressed to the bottom. Everybody got a lot closer. But in amongst the chaos, got to love at 7, who got themselves rolled by Mojo, a very unfamiliar and unpleasant experience for them. That was about 15 minutes ago. Well, now they're having to look at the back of Mojo. They're in upwind mode, they're in range on this small rig. They'll be having a good look at what's going on with Mojo. Look, a little light, a little knock down there.
I think they're all going to go through that patch of water, Mark.
Yeah, this is the transition. You're right. I mean, it's glass. It was not, maybe glass is too strong an expression, but there's a light patch coming up. Yeah, here goes 7 coming off the wire, and then they're back in again. Simon Nern, very bowed down. All his crew are off the wire, ahead on DeLonghi. They're going through that light patch as well. It's like a little doldrum zone, isn't it? It's a transition zone. Let's see who comes out of this in best shape. Again, a lot of gear changing required here. You wanna know your rig settings, that's for sure. You need a whole lot of power all of a sudden, then it'll all change when the breeze comes back in. But our front three on the water, Simon Nern on DeLonghi, a clear leader, Mojo second, 7 third, ASCO.
Lawrence is online, I've got a good lane up there in the high side. Yeah. He's tracking along just nicely and he's probably going to hold that pressure off the land a lot longer.
You might be right, Bob, and also I remember, Bob, a couple of days ago, I know it was much lighter conditions, but very similar wind angle, and the left was the place to be. All the winners, all the big gainers came from the hard left, and maybe again a plant is online remembering that. We're just not up tight and close behind ASCO here. I think we've talked about ASCO before. Kind of like the way they sail the boat here, Warwick, don't we? They're quite a nice, tidy unit.
No, those guys are going really well. It's in the boat's quick in both rigs. It's the old 7 hull, and not too sure. I think they've got all new rigs. No, that boat's very quick. I was just watching before. I mean, before 7 and Mojo were basically line astern, and looks like Nico's sort of got a bit more headed for a lot longer than 7, so they've lost a little bit of gauge to them.
Yeah, I just wonder if that header is going to come to 7 as well, maybe. Maybe in the end, the right could pay off. But it looked like that also a few days ago on a similar course. Looked really good to be on the right, but eventually all the gains came from the left. Maybe it's in all these courses where you have to be hard left to gain from the left or hard right to gain from the right, but avoid the middle. We've seen that this week, haven't we? Several times.
Yeah, definitely, definitely. Yeah, now they're like going through that quiet zone, but not as badly affected as the other guys from what I'm seeing. So Mick is going to be the big one here, isn't he?
Well, David, which right up on his hip, so interesting.
Hard left, exactly. Hard left, not too bad. A little lighter on the Plances now, but Woody's up here as well, even more left. Get to them in a second. We're just looking at the back of the fleet. Well, not so much, just behind us. Harry Hamlin on CST we're looking at now, as Warwick said, a great recovery from the top mark where he was looking pretty, pretty average indeed, but much better now for him. And then C-Tech also looked very ugly at that top mark. Good recovery from them as well. They're back in play here, not that far behind the leaders.
Well, interesting. I just think Plines on line's got his bow right up with, you know, it's sort of patchy, but when the pressure comes in, it's quite lifted.
And actually, even, you're right, even further left, just maybe go left or even more, Peter, for a second. Just pick up Sydney City Marine right alongside us here. There's our series sponsor's boat, just a little bit left here, Peter. There you go, tight under us. There's David Witts, guys. Clearly, they're one of the heaviest crews around. We've got at least one guy off the wire. It is a little light right now, but I wonder if trying to hang tight on this left-hand side, if that's going to come good, could happen. Well, I think if this lefty stays, you'd have to think that they would be hurt. But will David Witt on Sydney City Marine, can he sniggle his way around this corner? This is the Nielsen Beach corner, and get himself up to Rose Bay, or is he going to get, well, there's a knock he didn't want. He knows there's a lift coming. He'll look ahead. He'll see a plant's online bow up in pressure. It's going to come back to him. Just going to stay patient. Here we go. Little lefty on the Sydney City Marine machine.
And these sort of situations is where that communication, you know, from the forward hand, whoever is calling the breeze, is just so vital, because you sort of really want to be off the wire before that lull comes, because you don't want to keep pulling away. You don't want the boat pulling on top of you. So that determines how high they're going to be trapezing and all those sort of gear changes in the body mode.
So you say that there's the coming off the wire.
There's
exactly pat, right.
There's one more let down patch, and then I think it's pretty solid after that.
I think it is. I think Plants is online, that's right. Mick Elaine looking in extremely good shape here. He's sort of to the left, but not so far to the left that he ran out of the breeze, but definitely advantaged over the guys to leeward. I mean, yeah, it's off in the distance, so the hard right boat Mojo is now on starboard, looking to be quite high also, Warwick, a high starboard. I think Chris Nicholson's chosen his moment. We'll see what happens when he comes together with DeLonghi. We'll look at that, but for now, up here, Sydney City Marine playing this pretty nicely as well, I reckon. Maybe, I'm just wondering, when the next lefty comes in, I wonder if Whittier will just put his bow down and take it as a fast forward and not decide to come up into the cliffs anymore. But he's got wind, he's got the pressure he needs. Sailing nicely, that rig looks nicely set up, boat's going well. Quite a flat jib, I'm surprised by that, little Warwick. Had a quick little glimpse up the lee of his jib for a second there. Pretty hard sheeting. I'm sure we'll have a chance to look at that again in a second. But for now, Sydney City Marine, much better showing for them today. Rattled themselves downwind, chose the right side of the tanker. Looking pretty competitive upwind.
So where did Mojo go with DeLonghi? Did he cross it?
I missed the cross, but I've got a feeling they took their stern.
We're a bit blind. Our plants online was lined up so perfectly that we were blind between the two as they crossed. I think Mojo's just behind DeLonghi, but a lot closer. I think they're virtually boat for boat, those two.
So would Plants be second on the racetrack?
Mojo DeLonghi are 1-2, a Plants is 3, but not a lot in it. They're awfully close. I mean, Thurla Fisher right back in this. If you get any kind of a right-hand shift, 7 are going to look very flash. 7 just tacking now. That's the most right-hand boat. Any kind of a left shift, they'll look pretty poor. DeLonghi tacks, wants to stay this side of Shark Island. I just wondered for a second if Simon Owen was going to be really punchy and go around the far side of Shark Island. Well, maybe that's one risk too many. He's sailing a really nice race so far. You don't want to do anything too stupid, so... Looking further up the racetrack, I think Peter's giving us a pretty good, it's a long way away for our little camera, but out by the front it's DeLonghi on starboard coming together with Chris Nicholson on Mojo. I think DeLonghi's just ahead. Starboard rights, but no duck from Chris Nicholson. Oh, a little duck, that was bad a bow. Yeah, so they're dead equal, first equal. Plants on line and 7, another close cross coming up here. I think a Plants will cross, or maybe not. Really close cross coming up here. Plants on line on port, got a love at 7 on starboard. Plants can't duck from there, don't want to tack. Oh, this is going to be close. I think it's a super close cross. Just make it. Oh, an inch.
I reckon 7's waved them through.
Yeah, I think 7 did not want them tacking there, that's for sure. But if there was any bear away by 7, it was the tiniest one. Didn't really see any movement of that big bowsprit. So that's super close. 1 and 2, a boat for boat. 2 and 3, a boat for boat. Thurlow Fisher and Sydney City Marine are pretty damn close as well. There's nothing in this. We're coming to the top mark at Rose Bay.
More pressure.
There's extra breeze, a definite breeze increase as we come upwind. But the next mark is about 3 to 4 minutes away. Stay tuned to live stream here from Sydney Harbour. It's all happening. This is super important leg. After this leg, which of course is a long spinnaker reach down towards Sydney Harbour. And anyone who's got a lead at this top mark is likely to extend.
We've got a seaplane when you take off.
Yeah, not for the first time in Rose Bay. There's a very active, lively seaplane business. Seaplanes, there's about 4 of them. They fly to all over Palm Beach, particularly off to the airport, or wherever you want to go from here in Rose Bay. And they are yet another thing that you have to avoid if you're yacht racing or dinghy racing in the harbour. So Chris Nicholson, this time he has starboard rights, but I think DeLong is crossing him quite comfortably, actually. Well, by more than a boat length. So a little gain from DeLonghi. This is very good news for Simon Nern. He hasn't been at the front of a skiff fleet for a little while, and now he's up there. He's showing that he's got what it takes to stay ahead. Like a lot of the guys who end up in the mid fleet, which DeLonghi do, they talk about how hard it is to get out of the middle once you're there. Well, today he's at the front, and he's proving to be true to his word. He's at the front, and at the moment, he's staying there. As the seaplane goes by, you can smell that avgas, can't you?
Oh, I love it. I love that gas.
I love the smell of avgas in the morning. Yeah, that was the movie. So here we go. Simon Nern's DeLonghi. He's on lay for this. He's laying. He's even slightly cracked sheets. You're getting a little surf off our stern wave as well. He's rolling over the top of Mojo, who I'm not sure if they're going to lay. Seven definitely not laying. Seven have got to tack back. Yeah, Mojo giving it a go. Got to go very skinny now. They're sailing right up the backside of DeLonghi. They're going to have to sail high and thin to do this. But yeah, I think they're going to make it work, as you said. They will make it. Simon Nern still leads then at the top mark at Rose Bay.
Get your shirt on, boys.
Yeah, I think they will do. Nerny loves a spinnaker. Don't you worry about that. He's got plenty of kahunas, that Simon Nern and his team. A lot of them, they love it. Up it goes. Up goes the spinnaker. Mojo, great job by them. They are second round at the top mark. Third, got to love it, seven, keeping the pressure on. Another day of great consistency from Sevi and his team. Round they go in third place. Plants is online. That super close cross we had only a few minutes ago. Got to love it, seven, get the better of them into Rose Bay. Scott Babbage doing his magic as usual up in this bay. Next, and there goes the Plants online. This is a tight boat race, isn't it? Four, top four boats, all within 40 seconds of each other. And here comes Thurlow Fisher, Sydney City Marine, ASCO, proper yacht race. A long way to go, but at the moment, you kind of say any of this top seven or eight can win this race.
Yep, that's a good assumption. And I'd say he's caught up a lot of SeaTech. They were buried down there. They're in a sort of better lineup now.
Well, we talked about Harry as well. Harry Hamlin, Warwick mentioned them a while back. They've made an amazing recovery. Av have SeaTech. I'd say those two boats, probably the biggest movers, biggest place changers so far.
Yeah, for sure. They weren't anywhere near the top 10 at the top mark first time, so they've all come through very well.
David McDermott on Yamaha, he's top Kiwi vet at the moment, he's next round. As usual, he's never too far from his countrymen on SeaTech. Yamaha goes round, Harry Hamlin on CST, great job, leading master so far, long way clear of John Winning.
Higher appliances, first of the big rigs coming out.
Oh, here comes the big rig, there's the Smegglers, they got a very nice result yesterday, second.
Third, I think they were.
Oh, was the third, was it? I'm sorry. Was it third official? Mojo was second, you're quite right. So Meg were third. Podium for them. Now here comes the first, the big rig, Rick Peacock's Higher Appliances, followed by Alex on SeaTech. And then the Kitchen Maker, and yeah, Warwick can say there's a lot of spinnaker action up front. I think we might get up and have a look at this leading pack.
Certainly.
Let's go and see what's going on. Here goes the Kitchen Maker. We're going to scream down here. We're going to struggle to keep up with these spinnaker boats, but we'll see what we can do to get in amongst the action. There's a lot of breeze on this leg. Well, obviously the breeze is rotated round anyway, isn't it? It's a much more right-hand breeze. Makes it more of a knock-on port. But at the moment, I'm not sure anyone's going to lay the corner of Bradley's head looking forward there. They're a long way away. We'll get up to them as soon as we can. So the leader, Simon Nern, isn't laying. No one's laying. Mojo are probably the most affected. Seven giving it the best shots. Finding a high lane with the heavy crew weight. Big Sam Newton probably earning its keep right now. It's all going to be about the drops here, Warwick, isn't it?
ASCO's in trouble.
Oh, ASCO in all sorts of trouble there. Just got a big laugh, can't get the bow down. But up front, Seven doing a terrific job on this tight reach. If they could lay and not drop, that could be a race-winning manoeuvre for them.
Absolutely. No, Joe, it's deep on that point.
Same with the Pliances.
Oh,
And Winnie's moving.
Oh, look at this. Simon Nairn, the leader, dropping their kite, or they're just going to try and rag it. Maybe they'll rag all the way around the corner.
Mojo did it.
Mojo's a definite dropper. Look at Simon Nairn's DeLonghi. He's being punchy as you like. He's trying to get round here without dropping the spinnaker. He's so close to the rocks. Oh, my. Are we going to have our first written off 18-foot skiff? Is he going to get round the corner? What? He's so close to the rocks down there.
Super tight.
Wow, that is high risk sailing. Oh, he's hoping he can have a lifting centerboard right now. I think he's going to do it. Oh, that's very brave sailing from Simon's boys. Super brave sailing. Look,
that's really hurt Mojo. And that's just
well, maybe a light crew as well. We've talked about Mojo's light crew benefiting them on the previous reach. Maybe they paid the price there, Warwick.
Yeah, well, that's right. So now, you know, Mojo's going to have to come around and reset. So
look how deep the mark is. Keeping the kite up so important because now they've got round the corner. They're actually off the wire because they were trying to run deep. So dropping your spinnaker could not have been more painful there.
Yeah, exactly.
The end result of that, Simon Nairn, ballsy as you like, congratulations to his team. A really strong performance from all three of them on board that boat. They all hung tough when they needed to, and they're going to go around this bottom mark, still in the lead, holding their lead. They are being harassed and chased by some very high quality operators. Got to love it, Seven, at Plants Online, Mojo have rehoisted, Sydney City Marine, Thurlow Fisher, all the top dogs have got them in their sights, but for the moment, DeLonghi are up to the challenge. Conservative drop. Very, aren't they? Just look at that. Very conservative drop by DeLonghi, but that's the way to do it when you've got a lead. Working hard, they need to get that spinnaker. A little spinnaker is always the problem. Watch out for those wraps, lads. Stay calm. Let's get the jib in. Let's find some pan. Remember that it's a light airs down here.
Exactly. This breeze is really up and down.
Look, just a few seconds. And it's not even worth running a stopwatch on that. These guys are so close. There goes DeLonghi. That's our leader still. DeLonghi Rabideaux. Round they go, first place, second place, Seven, just one boat length back, Plants Online, both boats sailing an outstanding downwind leg, coming into the leader, holding their kites, some great skills on show. Chris Nichols' Mojo having to drop their spinnaker, the only one who did. They'll be disappointed by that, but they get away with it. Not too painful in the end, Warwick. I mean, I know they dropped some places, but in distance, they're just a few metres off the leader. Not too bad. Sydney City Marine had to jibe in the end, as has Thurlow Fisher. That's cost them a bit.
Seve's just tapped back. There's more breeze. He's looking. He's found some breeze. Simon Nairn comes back.
Yeah.
There's breeze off to the left there.
Yeah. Let's remember, we're in lightish airs. This is quite light for small rigs right now. You're hunting power. There's some different opinions what to do here. Our leader is to the right. They've tacked back as well in a decent amount of pressure. Seven, we're first to tack off. I'm not sure they've tacked into the most pressure right now. Oof, now as I say that, there's a huge right puff came to them. Too hard to call. I just have to see how this pans out. Basically nothing between the top four, even top five. Next boat's round after Sydney Marine was Thurlow Fisher. Then it's Asco, if anyone keeping scores here. And Thurlow Fisher tack away immediately following the rounding into a light spot. And then it's Howie's fast improving Howie Hamlin on CST. He's overtaken Yamaha. Another move for Howie Hamlin. Then Smeg. And then C-Tex close right up to this group. Alex Thaling is wanting to have a say in the result of this race, that's for sure. After an appalling start. Very ugly first mark rounding, but on the march, C-Tex. Second Kiwi boat. Yamaha, the top Kiwi at the moment. And then it's Kitchen Maker and then UK Hayer with a big rig there. Might have had a struggle to get around that Bradley's, I reckon, Warwick, but somehow he's made it round here.
It's the breeze just shifting around so much and the pressure's so up and down. And that's what I was saying before, you know, when Nico came around, I don't know that it had that much to do with their crew weight. I think it's more of the pressure they got, you know, at the time.
Yeah, you could be right. Combination of maybe several factors. Breeze slightly freshening now. A lot of traffic down here, a lot of sails sucking the air out.
Ooh.
Lots of shrouding. Just a windward boat call between C-Tech and Knight Frank, two Kiwis sharing a bit of love. Both on starboard, but that was a windward leeward boat. And round goes Yandu, that's the second master, John Winning. He's second in the Masters Championship at the moment, behind Harry Hamlin. Inside him, that's Rag and Famish. Not the best rounding I've seen them do. Then it's Knight Frank and then Grant Rollison. We haven't talked about Rollo today, have we, on Fisher and Paykel?
way back.
We've seen him much today. He's got a lot of work to do. Pika coming soon. I was expecting much bigger things from them today. I think they got the right rig up. I think the big rig's probably still the way to go, but not showing it on the race course and performance, so maybe in the end it hasn't quite worked. And then Kenwood, the boat we saw had that big tangle at the start line. They were stationary, actually going backwards after the start gun, so they've had to make a recovery and have made a decent one.
Has anybody seen Smeg?
Yeah, Smeg went around a few minutes ago. Probably just outside the top 10, but not too bad.
Okay.
Meanwhile, at the top of the rig, we might rattle up there because this beat is short and sweet, and it looks like it's a very tight race upwind between Appliances, Seven and DeLonghi. Nothing between those three. A little more than halfway up this very short beat. We'll get up to the top, tell you what's going on.
Gotta love it. Edsley's way in front of Simon Nern. I think they came about. He was the first one to tack down the bottom. You saw that breeze coming in from the left, and it's once again one of those master strokes. When they have a look around, Simon was just probably just sailing on. He wanted to cover him, whatever he tacked back to, but it just let him get into that breeze a bit quicker, man.
Yeah, finding a bit of extra boat speed, I think, as well. But a shifty, tricky beat. Seven doing the right thing, going the right way. And they are going to go around first. The plants online attached to them by, well, it looks like a fairly tight bit of elastic. Not much again. There was about a boat length and a half last rounding. Now it's maybe two boat lengths. Nothing between them. DeLonghi give up their first place, but still they're well and truly in this race. They go around nice and tight, and they'll be third behind the plants online.
And the shaker and mover here has been Michelin Appliances Online. If we think about that, but they were at the bottom mark the first time. These guys have just rocketed through the place.
Certainly have. They most certainly have.
Another manly ferry coming around. Bradley's cleaned a few out. So get them on early, boys. Get low, and they're going low. Seven's not laying Bradley's right now.
That's the angle. Here we go. Yet again, they've all gone the kilo, the early hoist. All gone the early hoist. And what's happened is, well, at the moment, no one's even nearly laying the mark. We're back to the whole crew weight and where's the shift and where's the pressure issue. I don't see anybody laying this, but maybe we'll get a lift. Simon then finds a bit of height there and goes high lane straight away. Michael Coxon's just gone round. He's hoisting his kite with no boat speed at all, which is usually a recipe for something ugly happening, but he kind of gets away with it. He just hoists in a lull. Next round is Mojo. Mojo has had a shocker. He actually had a shocking last 10 minutes, haven't they, really? Didn't lay Bradley's, dropped the kite. A little bit ugly on the last part of the run, and then got that beat wrong. So Mojo definitely slipping back at the time when Appliances were probably slipping forwards the most.
Rise and rise of C-Tech, they just keep chipping away.
I know we keep saying it, but you're right, chipping away and some, and not just chipping away, overtaking. They've just overtaken two boats in this last leg alone. They've overtaken CST, and they've overtaken their countryman Yamaha. They're going to be very close to City Marine, David Witt, who's probably overlaid and forces C-Tech to tack thin, which is a nice plan. City Supermarine should just roll C-Tech here. I think they probably will. C-Tech, well, no, they're both going to lay all right. Sydney was well overlaid there, so that was David Witt's boat, City Supermarine. C-Tech holding Sydney Supermarine up, holding them high. Holding them fair, yeah, holding them well high. But I think David Witt's guys are going to roll. Extra crew weight's going to show. Well, that's certainly both happening. They're both delaying. Witty giving a lot of verbal to C-Tech, saying, "Go on, bow down, lads, get your kite up." Now they both go for it. two kites up, both ended up in a high lane initially, Warwick. I mean, that might not hurt them in the end. Maybe the high lane will work out.
No, I don't think so. I think they're going to hurt each other doing that because they're starting up to softer air here. And we're getting tangled up here very nicely. But, yeah, just the pressure so up and down, and all those guys have easily laid Bradleys when they weren't looking so early on. So, yeah, that wasn't a good move from those two boys. They need to work together.
Yeah, I've got to close up the gaps, you're right. Well, the fleet initially hoisted, didn't look like they had a hope of getting around Bradleys, but that was just a very temporary knock. The breeze lifted back and all the boats are laying pretty comfortably, all firing straight at the target. At the moment, that's advantage seven, so the leader has extended already in this little leg. Lance on line, a second, Rabideau's DeLonghi are third. And interesting, there's Michael Coxon in fourth, choosing a low lane. He's very happy to let the bow go down. I think he reckons there's a lift coming up. He's fancies, and there goes Chris Nicholson and Mojo as well.
Elliot on SeaTech just come on stack.
Oh, yeah, that was a little bit of drama just near alongside us, but SeaTech solved the problem. Hallie Cleek came undone. They've solved that problem. That's all sorted. Quite interesting, though, Warwick, the low lane that we're seeing Polar Fisher and Mojo in. And in the meantime, up front, I'm seeing DeLonghi sailing into a nasty hole. Suddenly, they've got two guys off the wire. You don't want that. So quite patchy. I think that's the conclusion we get from this is the breeze hasn't really established itself properly. It's a little up and down, plenty of holes. And you don't want to count your chickens, do you?
Absolutely not. And, you know, you want to be as low as you can without, you know, running the state of the obvious, without running the risk of having to drop your chute. So at the moment, Thurlow's looking in a nice position to gain here. Just depends what the next sector's going to be as they just get maybe another 100 metres up, the breeze out of Rose Bay as it funnels down out of there.
Yeah, everyone's having their moments, so coming off the wire, we're seeing boats charging along, flat chat free wiring like you're watching ASCO doing right now. And then all of a sudden they go light, they go bow up, off the wire. And this breeze is still, well, it's forecast to drop, isn't it? And this is often what we see, a breeze that's starting to fade. The first indication you get is a series of big bits of vacuum, big holes. And then those holes extend and extend, and suddenly the hole becomes the average. But right now, this breeze, well, exactly, the next breeze, there's a gust coming. I've got all of our front three boats so flat out that they're not even laying the next corner. So 1 minute they're way bow up thinking about jibing. The next minute they can't even lay the target. So that tells you just quite how shifty things are out here right now. But Michael Coxon in general, I think, has played quite a nice game down here. He's broadly gone depth whenever he could, gone the low lane whenever he could. And he stands to gain as long as it doesn't come in too firmly in the next minute or two. To a bit of him, Chris Nicholson. Well, a little recovery from him. You'd say he's coming into the top three at the moment. He'll be a bit frustrated, won't he? We're just saying today that we're really seeing a slightly new Chris Nicholson today. He's on fire, and up until half an hour ago, it was all going beautifully for him. Then a real bad little patch he went through.
Yeah, well, I mean, a lot of it was out of their control, and we're seeing it here. That, as you said, you know, the guys have got, you know, 35 degree course changes because of the pressure. The pressure's, you know, maybe at sort of 8 knots 1 second, and then 16, you know, 30 seconds later, and Chris got caught out on that run there, but then he decided to keep going right up that last beat when all the rest of the fleet, his main adversaries, went left, and that really hurt him. He lost a lot of ground there. But now coming back into it again, this, you know, but out the front is seven.
Seven have managed to get out the front of Plances, doing their best to hang on. And DeLonghi decided they quite like life at the front and not wanting to give that game up. Much more fun being at the front than the back. And I think Simon Nern's heading for player of the day at the moment in my book, Bob. I don't know what you think. Certainly nice to talk to someone who's experiencing life at the front, who usually is experiencing more counting, more the boats behind him.
Sounding like a demon.
He's sailing, well, all three, Kieran, Karen on the front, doing some very sterling work on that big heavy spinnaker sheet. I can see the whole lot of them working hard. Simon Commodore, actually, of the Yacht Club. He's a Brit, fellow Brit like myself, came out here about 10 years ago. He's very involved in skiff sailing in Europe before he came here, and since he's been here, he's sailed skiffs on the harbour pretty much every weekend of his 10 years.
They're working hard Commodore. To get it over up past ASCO Rock, and they don't want to hit that one.
Aren't they just? We don't want the Commodore ashore on the rocks. Not a good look for the club. Oh, a little look behind for Simon. He looks pretty casual, doesn't he?
Yeah, he's pretty casual. Yeah, how you going, guys? What's happening? Well, he's in the podium. That's what's happening right now, and looking very good.
Very good indeed. A lot of hard work on the front. The Kiwi, Kieran Cowan on the front, giving it loads of attitude. That's the way to do the front on a skiff. You've got to be big and strong, and you've got to have plenty of attitude, that's for sure. You don't want to let these boats get on top of you. Like a lot of overpowered boats, Warwicker, you kind of got to make sure that the boat knows who's boss.
Yeah, well, that just takes, you know, three skillful people and plenty of practice.
And Mika.
Tommy Anderson working the chute on the pirate ship, and Paul Monty on the sheet. Nice solid guy in the middle of that boat, and Mika Lane on the stick, just cruising it down here, and not giving a lot of weight. They've got to love it right now, Mark. They're hanging in.
Oh, I agree. I think they're right. I'm really impressed with how they're sailing. I think, talk about Simon Ehrlich and relax. Well, Mika, he's always relaxed, isn't he? He's a pretty cool cat, Mika. Nothing seems to stress him too much.
Well, you got that right. Get up to our leader. High strings, high hooks.
High strings, you're right. They don't want to jibe here if they can avoid it. They want to stay three wiring all the way in one. No interest in jibing and opening the door to the guys behind. Charging down in their favourite small rig. Small rig is the weapon of choice for them. They love that. They know that they've got a bit of a speed advantage with it. And today, just a click of speed, I think. Some good sailing from seven. Picking the right side of most of the runs and the reaches so far. Not having it their own way, though. Mojo, that overtake on them on leg two, you'll remember. Just rolled straight through them.
Big Sammy Newton. Stuff this red shirt in the bag.
Yep.
On his own.
Let's see it. He said on interview yesterday on the post-match that the secret to avoiding screw-ups we're about to see now is masses of practice and masses of good boat work, boat prep. Well,
there they go.
There he goes. He said to me, if you don't want to have a twist, that's what you do. Well,
blow the pair of them.
There he goes. And be big and strong enough, as you said, to blow both simultaneously and pull them both in. So it helps to be big and strong and 6 foot, I don't know what Sam is, 5, 6 foot 4, 6 foot, something like that. And agile. Got to be agile, haven't you, in these boats? So seven making that look like a very standard business as usual maneuver. Second round appliances, a pretty tidy drop. They're a little lower for the mark there, so they drop a little earlier. But Tom Monty doing a super job of boat handling. Here comes Simon Nerns, DeLonghi, Kieran getting his arms well and truly around the kite. Nice drop from him as well. Good job from DeLonghi. They go around in third.
The difference there was that Seven's got two on the rack while Sam puts it away.
Yeah.
A lot faster.
Yep, that's for sure. There's a little difference. Bit of improvement from Chris there. Chris, yeah. Nicholson's mojo fired down there in the end, made a bit of a gain in the end on Cocco, but Michael Coxon is in this battle still. He's our Mr. Consistent. He's always there or thereabouts, and he's going to have another very good counter today. Unfortunately for him, Seven are going to have an even better counter, which is going to be a bit annoying when he looks at the score sheet, but another good day for Cocco.
He'll have a picket fence.
Yeah, no doubt. I mean, he is, you know, he has been very, very consistent, but Seven's just starting to chalk up those wins.
Interesting in there, if you say Warwick, Chris Nicholson tacks away immediately. First boat to tack away from our leading group. The other three are all carrying on starboard, up to the south side of the harbour. Chris Nicholson straight into attack, heading for the other side. He wants a split. He's not interested in the fourth place today. He wants to win.
Absolutely, absolutely. So he's getting plenty of leverage on that leading group. And as we said, he did close right up to the back of DeLonghi at the end of that run, so...
Look what a good job David Witt's done on the Sydney City Marine. He went round that last mark alongside C-Tech from New Zealand. They had that little luffing match.
And then, they lost a halyard.
They did lose a halyard, right, but it was only like a 10-second or so incident. It wasn't, but you're right, they did lose the halyard, but David Witt taking advantage of that and doing a nice job extending on them. He's in this little fight as well, so... I don't think any of these boats, even including Alex Fading, is on C-Tech. Bear in mind the forecast is to soften. We're not expecting it to be any kind of a shutdown, but it is going to get progressively softer as the day goes on. There's still plenty left in this racetrack. Next around, C-Tech. There they go. Not a lot of racetrack left in terms of numbers of legs. I still think there's going to be place changes, though, but we've got this long beat to Rose Bay, then it's that screaming reach, assuming there's still some wind, that very tight reach that we saw before, down towards the other side of the harbour of Sydney Yacht Squad, and then it's a beat to the finish. So just three legs to go. breeze a little soft looking up the racetrack. I'm thinking Warwick. I mean, I'm not thinking people are going to be on one wiring and thing, but it's a soft kind of three wiring, isn't it? Maybe those conditions, the lighter crews, thinking about Mojo particularly, maybe this is going to suit them.
Yep. No, it definitely has softened. But I think what we've seen it, you know, at different times. I mean, like here are guys struggling to get down to the mark now. It's gone that soft, and you know, only like 3 minutes ago that they were getting mapped. So it's just coming in waves, I think, Mark. It might not be an overall, you know, dropping of pressure. I think it's just, as you said before, it's, you know, we're getting holes in the breeze. And see, just looking up the track now, the breeze is coming back in. Looks like it's gone a little bit left. David Witt looks quite up there on port tack. Seven's gone the furthest to the east, and looks like Mojo's bailed out of that manoeuvre, and he's heading hard left as well at the moment.
The first of the big rigs, Hay Appliances. Once again, the little rigs have rounded them up again. Just way more efficient, and those guys sail that boat pretty damn well. So, second rigs went out today, for sure and certain.
I think it's looking a bit lighter up. The guys who've gone the furthest over, we'll wait and see. Those obviously appliances are tacking away, splitting tacks with seven, lining up with DeLonghi. DeLonghi doing quite nicely there. Actually, I'd say closed up to appliances online, in fact. Nothing between those two boats. Seven still leading. Certainly, they'll all be thinking about this last beat, though. We saw, you remember the last time we came up here, where the boats that went hard, that were tightening on the left, they did extremely well. That was Sydney Marine Appliances. And the boats that went pretty firmly hard right, that was Chris Nicholson. He did quite well too. It was really the middle was a less good place to be on that particular occasion. Certainly all the crews will be discussing that right now. You've kind of got to make a plan. I suspect you go hard left or you go hard right. Try to avoid the middle. That could cause some issues for seven. Might be trying to cover boats on two sides at once. Yeah, DeLonghi have actually pulled through appliances online. I'm a little bit far away, but we'll move our way up to the leaders in a second. And we'll give you all the action as it happens. Last long beat up to Rose Bay. And there's obviously the very final leg of the race course. There's a tiny short leg. Where are we going? DeLonghi finding a way through appliances online. But it does feel a little bit like they're spending too much time in each other's company at Warwick. I mean, in the meantime, the leader's just inching away from them. Yeah, so pretty tight up here. Warwick, tell us what you think is happening between these three. So we've got Appliances, DeLonghi and Mojo battling out for the 2-3-4 slot.
Yeah, I think Mojo's come back, got back into these guys a lot, and I think he's actually closed up ground to seven, and maybe that battle, it's almost like a little match race going on there between Appliances and DeLonghi, might be helping Nico and his team out a little bit here. Seven going through that transfer zone we talked about last time. Very, very soft this time. Had everybody off the wire.
That suggests a similar thing to last time. As you said, we came up here and we all had to go to that little light air transition zone. Some played that better than others.
Look what Chris Nicholson's doing. He's obviously sailing in a high tight mode, and he's trying to squeeze up underneath appliances, and he's bowed down now. He's going to that light air, but I noticed he was just concentrating on getting it up underneath these boats.
Yeah, I think these three have got themselves in a battle, but none of them have really fallen off the back of seven here. As you said, if anything, maybe they've squeezed up to seven. Seven's not disappearing on the horizon at all. It's light, it's tricky, it's funky. It's not seven's most favourite conditions, and these three are giving it to seven. They're making sure this battle goes all the way. All three of them fancy their chances to win this race. If they can just avoid slowing each other up, I think they've got a decent chance of getting on the very top step of this podium.
Yeah, absolutely. It's, we're getting closer to the end, but there's still plenty going on, isn't there?
Well, the spinnaker run to try and clear Bradley, you saw what happened last time, which upset Nojo, so that's still to be taken account of.
Absolutely right, Bob. We've got that to come, and then we've got that really short little run immediately after, where do you jibe, what do you do, and then a tricky beat lay, there's plenty going on here. They're all closing into seven. Let's look at this. Simon DeLonghi's done superbly. Simon Nairn's team rolling into seven there at the moment, a little higher, a little faster. Look at this. I'd say all three boats are coming into seven right now. That transition zone, which seven have had to experience first, seems to be costing them more than the others.
And it's funny, Mark, you know, you were talking about the high road here paid dividends last time, and even though Mojo was only maybe, you know, 100 metres, maybe not even 100 metres to leeward of appliances and DeLonghi then, they just missed out on the up pressure and the lifts that both appliances and DeLonghi got and have dropped out of this again. And no doubt DeLonghi has taken, you know, at least 50% of the lead that seven had out of that just in the last few minutes.
Absolutely, no question at all. I mean, at the moment, seven would tack and cross, but not by much. Not by much. Doesn't take much. 5-degree lift here, and seven suddenly aren't tacking and crossing. So we've got a boat race in our hands, and it's been no doubt at all. There's two more legs to go after this one. One's a long reach, and one's a short beat. It's not that much time, but probably, what, 20 minutes of racing left in front of us in a dying breeze. Our top four within just maybe 50 metres between all four of them. There's nothing in this race at all. Got a love at seven. They've got three bullets on the scorecard. Another win today would make it hard to think the end result will be anything other than a win for them overall. But funny things happen. If they dropped a couple of places here, that could give them the wobbles. That could take away some of this important self-confidence.
I think he's just wiping the water off the lens. With Douglas doing some nice polishing work there. Back in business.
Kind of waiting for one of the boats to shake it up. I'm also almost thinking that Chris might tack over and try and start asking some questions to people here. It's all a little bit of a straight line drag race, playing into seven's hands a bit for everyone. I'm sure they're very happy that everyone's following them. Yeah, I would have thought Mika
might be happy where he is.
Yeah, I just wondered whether Mika and Mojo might to think about rolling the dice a little bit here. Plenty of breeze on both sides of the racetrack right now. It's going to be shifty as you like up here. Plenty up for grabs in terms of shifts.
Well, there's going to be a bit of a tack fest coming up. They're just going to stretch it out here till they get more towards Shark Island, I guess.
Yeah, that's right. But there is more breeze on the left than there has been for a while. I quite like the look of the left at the moment. It looks quite fresh off Nielsen.
They're all up at the moment, aren't they?
Yeah, and it's not a crazy... There's a bit of a lift. It's not a crazy high lift. So, well, we'll see what happens. This battle will unfold.
Simon then needs to get up a bit higher. He needs to go higher to get up on his hip. Put him under a little bit, give him something to think about. There he goes. Just a couple of those would be good. A little bit more of that, please.
See all boats in range with a small rig. Nobody's having to wire too high. Certainly the bottom end of the rig, that's for sure. They can handle an awful lot more wind than this, but they're getting away with it. You can see quite an eased outhaul on Simon's boat. Pretty grunty full setup all the way through. Plenty of depth in the mainsail right now. Same with the jib. Plenty of power in that. Which he needs. He's got a slightly heavier crew. I think maybe seven are actually even heavier than him, but he's a bit heavier than the other two boats. But he's doing nicely, isn't he? There's no question that. DeLonghi looking very competitive indeed against some extremely fast boats, and he has that all the way around the racetrack.
Well, the good thing about DeLonghi today, he gave himself a real crack because he got a blinding start, so he bought a ticket to race today, there's no doubt. And once you get clear, and if you've got some boat speed, well, he's certainly got some boat speed with that rig in this condition. He's hanging right in there and giving him something to think about, the big red seven. And great race, so this is going to go beautifully down.
Oh, we've lost a crewman. Crewman's just fell overboard. That's Kieran on the bowman, just came unhooked, or did maybe the trapeze wire broke, or trapeze string broke. I think you happen to think Peter had you on camera as well. Great positioning by Bob driving, and Peter, the instinctive cameraman, knows what to film. Wow, that was unexpected. That picked up the heart rate up for sure. He's back on the wire, so it wasn't the wire that broke. He came unhooked, or I don't know what happened. We'll find out. Well, you know one thing's for sure, we're going to be interviewing DeLonghi after this race.
Yeah, well, he got the player of the day.
No, he already got, he didn't need to do that. But we could say to Simon, you'd already got player of the day, no need to throw in some drama for us. It's funny how little that lost them, actually. No one really made any great impression. They dropped a little bit of height on seven with a distraction. Kieran giving us a thumbs up, he knows we filmed it.
And what's the predictions on his heart rate, you reckon, at that time?
Thumping.
Well, there you go. We're going to have a wet bowman and a...
It's like being a winger running down to score the try. He's only got to step inside the fullback and he puts his foot into touch, mate. He just feels nothing.
So all four boats going all the way to the Shark Island ley line. I'm surprised by that, Warwick. I have to say, I'm very surprised one of these three hasn't broken away a lot earlier. But it's made Seven's job very easy indeed. Just keep on going and keep on going. Everyone is following them, so no one's going to be able to overtake them as long as that happens.
I just think they all just want to be in touch with each other for the run to the judge, and there's plenty on the table there.
Yeah, no, I think I know what you mean. I know what you mean. There's no point getting the obviously wrong way. I'm just not sure that tacking away was obviously wrong at all. I think there was plenty in it. Anyway, this is, we are where we are. Got a love at seven, looking in good shape as they head off across Rose Bay. They're going to be trying doing minimal tacks across here if they can get away with it. DeLonghi broadly following them. DeLonghi's still in second position. And just to the right there, Peter, I don't think that they'll come off his trapezoire for the second time, as we never will. Maybe they will. There we go. There's Mojo in a plants online. That shows you where the top four are. There's not a lot between these boats still. It's probably 30 seconds, maybe 35 seconds between all four.
It's going to be, this run across to Bradley is going to be way important. It's just a matter of how much puff you can get to get you low without missing the point like Mojo did last time. But if you can line up some puff, you really, that's where the back markers, if Seve doesn't get something to really light it up early, and he's sitting in some light stuff, the other guys could really come to him down here.
Yeah, right. And of course, by the other thing, we could have the opposite problem where they all get a bit spooked by what happened last time, go too high, and then end up having to do lots of jibing into that boy.
I'll back that out. I think they know what's got to be done here. Just go for gold. Shoots on.
Seven tacks. On ley line, on a skinny ley line, but on ley line for the Windward mark. A minute sailing or so for them to get to that mark. Any kind of a righty, they won't be laying. Any kind of lefty, it'll be comfortable, but they'll have to, they've got enough of a leader to see how things go. Nicely on lay at the moment, just to... Probably got a boat length in hand, if that. We'll see how they go. So there are leader on the water. Behind them, DeLonghi, just off to the left. It's a plants online, Mojo and Thurlow Fisher. Kind of Thurlow Fisher, sort of joining in this group a little bit, Warwick.
Yeah, they are closing up a little bit. And I was just having a look around and trying to do some numbers on where the regatta would fall if everybody finished in the places they are right now. And from my best estimates, without drops, Seven would be on 16, Thurlow would be on 22, Mojo would move up to third on 30, and C-Tech would be fourth, maybe with a 31 or 32 scorecard. So the place on the podium are not over yet, that's for sure.
All right, there's plenty of close, and then in come the drops, and it gets very interesting. For second backwards, the first becomes a very clear. There's got a love at seven, who go around our top mark for the last time. Got a love at seven, the leader. Of course, with a drop, they'd be dropping the 12th. They'd be counting, if they win today, four bullets. That's quite a tough scoreline to do anything about when there's only two races to go. Anyway, next back, we need some a couple of real shockers from seven to, well, at least one real shocker to shuffle that up. But second on the race course, yeah, it would need a black flag, yeah, which we've seen, there's plenty of them. Already two in the regatta, two black flag starts. I can't remember the last time we had even one. Anyway, second round of the race course, very impressive sailing from the DeLonghi Rabideaux team.
Mojo in the third.
Lost a place, but they pulled back a place during that leg.
Delaying this
second. Delaying this on DeLonghi. DeLonghi around second. They'll be pleased with that. But third goes around Plantis. Mojo's closed right up with the plants online, getting the shifts right up into Rose Bay. Nice job by the Mojo team. They go around fourth. Next round will be Thurlow Fisher, but we're going to go down and follow the leaders, see how they do on these tricky spinnaker angles down here. Lances go early with the spinnaker. Seven have already gone. Mojo wants...
Seven are soft. clear soft seven.
Yeah, that's what I was kind of wondering about. But if it goes soft, they all get caught high. What happens then?
Mojo,
you're just saying Mojo have a tear. Where's the tear, Warwick?
Yeah, they've just got a tear maybe in the second panel, just about where the J is on their logo, near the luff of the chute. So hopefully that's not going to explode on them.
But it is light ahead, as you said. Seven have got one crewman, that'll be Scott, who's off the rack. Rabideau's, Kenwood, the DeLonghi Rabideau's boat, they have got 1.5 off the wire. All of a sudden, being light crew, Chris Nicholson's going, hang on, guys, we've got a chance here. We could do something here. Let's work this hard. We can certainly get ourselves to second, maybe even do more damage than that. So they're all high. Remember, the mark is just off Bradley's head, which is about 50 degrees to the right of where they're pointing right now. And so this is becoming a lighter jibing run.
What do you do either, jibe off? If you can connect the black dots down here, it'd be pretty dynamic if you could.
Well, you wouldn't want to get caught on a Point Piper, Bob, would you hear? I mean, that, we're pretty, well, unless you get
that's
to...
That's what I'm getting.
Yeah, I agree. I think you'd be thinking about jibing.
Sevy's still light and lifted, and there's nothing much in front of them, so you could just spit yourself down 100 metres.
Yeah, if you get the stream out of Double Bay, the breeze from there, then you can be all right. Oh, here we go. We've got appliances online here in Mojo. A little bit of a coming together from these two. They are going to affect each other, there's no doubt about that. I think they know the bigger picture is take the puff, get your bow down. Appliances is online doing that really well. DeLonghi running into a big hole of wind, almost a capsize to windward from them. So this is very expensive for DeLonghi right now. Appliances and Mojo coming into them at speed. These three are going to end up in a little log jam because I don't think anyone's going to break through to leeward of DeLonghi. All of a sudden, Simon Nern gets one of those puffs out of Double Bay and off he goes. Concertina time, isn't it, Warwick? We've seen this before. They're all attached to a bit of elastic and they all take their turns.
Yeah, for sure. And looking ahead now, Seven's got huge pressure and it's getting mapped. So, yeah, it's just the up and down snakes and ladders, isn't it?
Yeah, our leader has suddenly found a lovely puff just when they wanted it, just as they were clear of the head, and Seven just firing down towards the target, three wiring. It's good news for them. Breeze comes back for these three, just back in time for DeLonghi.
Big pressure coming through.
Big pressure coming now. Now all of a sudden, Mojo, I wish they could buy a few extra pounds, kilos of lard on board, aren't they? Well, they don't want to have to drop the kite again. That hurt them last time.
No, they don't want to do that. But they've rolled appliances online. You see Nico, they're using the old 5-0 technique. Got arms. Everybody's arms are out in the air. They're looking for every pound and leverage and height that they can get. So they're coming into DeLonghi as well. So... This second and third place for this race is wide open, isn't it?
It is. We saw that very brave move from DeLonghi last time. It looked like they didn't have a hope of getting around the corner. And somehow, Simon scraped the boat around the rocks. Well, this time, relatively, it's comfortable for him, but he's still got a little bit of work to do. You wouldn't want the bowman coming off the wire right now, would you?
No, that wouldn't be a good act.
Right, DeLonghi looking like they're going to just have enough skills and composure to sneak around this corner. There's a very tricky beat to finish. Remember, everyone who's watching this race who hasn't seen this course before, there's still one leg after this rounding, not much more sailing, 15 minutes, maybe 10 minutes. A light airs tricky short beat to the finish. We're getting close to the end of race 5 here from Sydney Harbour on Thursday. Tomorrow, of course, is a lay day for us. It's a day off.
Thank you very much. I'm more than happy.
Yeah. A few people will be looking forward to the lie-in. And then we have the big weekend coming. Saturday, Sunday, an outstanding forecast. It's looking like there's breeze and sunshine for both days. Two more days to go. Going to be brought to you live from the Camera Cat. You won't miss a minute if you dial into www.18footerstv.com for all the action. Today, our day sponsor is Kenwood, Rabideau's, DeLonghi, and of course Sydney City Marine, our event sponsor. Winning Appliances, their supporter, and Livestream brought to you with the help of our good friends, the Sony Anarchy.
What are they going to do here, Mark? They're going to soak down to this?
Well, you wouldn't want to jibe, would you? Simon Nern's guys particularly thinking, we don't want to jibe here. Well, they're just bring a man off the wire. There's one off the wire so far. Do whatever it takes to not have to jibe. They're a big blocker on Mojo. Not much Mojo can do other than just try and have a clean rounding. And Mojo will be thinking about the early tack away unless DeLonghi has a messy rounding. That's probably the thought process going on right now. See if DeLonghi opens the door for them, and if they don't, set up for an early tack. Here goes DeLonghi, bow down for the drop. Oh, he's had to put a jibe in. He's had to put a little cheeky jibe in, so will Mojo. There's no water.
He'll be on starboard.
Yeah, well, no water. Simon then got into three boat lengths, and there's no way there's any water there for anyone.
Okay.
It's like a team race, isn't it? Just stop at the mark. Here comes the plants, it's flying in at speed, all three going to go around simultaneously. This is now light airs, boat handling skill time. Nice little rounding by DeLong, they did that very nicely. Did what he had to do, no need to rush to get the... Oh, and he's hit them! That's a foul from Mojo. That's going to happen. Mojo will have to do turns. That is careless for a man of Chris's experience.
Who got him?
Mojo hit DeLonghi on the rounding, and DeLonghi was the boat clear ahead. Mojo, no rights whatsoever, taking their turn, taking their punishment.
Wow.
That was just a misjudgment from Chris Nicholson. Very keen to tack away into clean air, and he just forgot for a second that he's got a 12-foot bowsprit out the front of the boat.
Yeah, and the thing is that, you know, I think he did it 722, but look, he's just having a go, you know. It was always tricky. He needed to get inside, try and get inside there, and he just misjudged by a little bit. But anyway, he took his turns and move on.
And nothing saying he can't get back to second. This beat is a shifty old beat, and it's worked out nicely for Simon Nern's team. But to be honest, he's not going to rest comfortable. The seven seem to have been launched and gone. It's feeding foregone. They're going to win this race.
You see Michael Coxon looking around. Yeah. Earnestly, they're trying to find something to put together here.
He is. He's thinking, how about if I hit hard right, lads? What about it? Is this our chance to go for it? Well, everything suggests, Warwick, that the good news is on the left-hand side of this beat. Anything on the right to interest you?
It's hard to say.
Oh, I don't know, to be honest. It's a bit what you got at the time. You got to work with what you got. I mean, up further up the course, seven's very high on starboard tack with pressure. But it seems to me that the left was paying more dividends most of the time, wasn't it?
Cocker's having a look at it. It's what I thought he'd do. I mean, he's kind of thinking, well, it's not that it's race over, but from a serious point of view, he really needs to get into a second or third kind of position. And
he's got his bow down a bit.
He's in pressure. He's gone bow down. He's kind of thinking, well, you know, everyone keeps going left, but the conditions have changed. So now every beat's a different beat. A ferry coming over just to slice the fleet in two, as usual. But he's got pressure. He's looking all right. He's giving it a go. He's rolling the dice a little bit for sure. But I think he feels it's the time of the regatta. He's got to do something.
Well, he's got to clear this ferry, which I think he's across. No, he's going to have a real go, isn't he?
Well, he's going to have to go hard right. But he's got pressure. He's looking around the race course. He's got probably a little more wind, actually, than there is on the other side of the race course. Just a little, not a big difference, but a little. But as Warwick said, you look up the racetrack, you can see seven in the middle of the beat, but always looking bow up on starboard. That means there's a right shift that's working its way down the race course. And I think Coco's seen that, and he's hoping to get a little bit of that right action. He's tacked now. He's going to get the right side of the ferry by the skin of his teeth. So I'm not sure that's the regulation 300 metres, but we'll turn a blind eye to that one. If you viewers at home will do the same, we'll all keep quiet because we want Cocker to have a crack at this. Get in amongst the top three would be good. He's got a fishing boat to his left, which I hope is going to slow down for him. A rather sinister looking red fishing boat with blacked out windows. Looks like a Russian spy boat. There it is. Peter's showing you the Russian spy boat. Not sure how many fish they got on board that one. An unusual amount of electronics, sir, for a fishing boat, I think. What exactly is that encoder doing in your what I thought was supposed to be crab pots? Anyway, Cocker's sailing through the light spot created by the ferry. That's the breeze bounces back. He's unfortunately going to get rolled by the Russian fishing boat. Has the boat gone to leeward of him? Ooh, hard to tell from this. Have a quick look at this. I think he's going above it. We'll see.
Yeah, he's crossed.
Oh, he got above it. Thank you. Thanks. Thank you, Mr. Fisherman. Did a good job. So, but he is in light airs, looking further up the beat. Oof.
And Mark, it's out of camera shot, but a great battle going on for the Masters where John Whiting slipped ahead of Howie Hamlin on CST.
You're absolutely right, and then we'll see how that develops up here. I don't know how that happened. Howie had a huge lead, didn't he? But the previous beat, that long beat up from Obelisk, well, there's a lot to play for there. Must have been where he made his move. Anyway, here we are at the top of the beat for the last time. Our winners, got 11-7 on camera now. We haven't talked about them the last few minutes. To be honest, they've been clear ahead, looking comfortable winners. They are going to win again, Heat 5 of the JJ Giltinan. That's going to take them to 4. Bullets, that's a hard scoreline to argue with. Another great day of sailing for them. They had a decent start, not the absolute best, but a decent start. Played that first beat well, popped out of the left-hand side, came over on a nice shift, got round the first mark in good shape. I'm not sure their first or second were, I think they were second, weren't they? But anyway, from then onwards, they extended until Simon Nern had his little moment of glory for a lap or two. Chris Nicholson had a pop it in and overtook Seven for a while, but ever since then, Seven have got to the front and stayed there. not their absolute favourite conditions. Lightish airs, they like a bit more breeze, but kind of whatever conditions you throw at this polished team, they seem to have an answer. Congratulations, the three boys on God Love at Seven, Sevi Jarvin, Scott Babbage, Sam Newton, another very impressive performance indeed. Very impressive from God Love at Seven. Here come the rest of the fleet. Just before they do, Warwick, a quick comment on Gotta Love at Seven. What is going to have to happen for these guys to not win this championship? What options are there for the rest of the fleet?
Oh, I reckon hacksaws.
Hacksaws at dawn. Hacksaws at dawn is the call from Warwick. Okay. Well, you heard it here first. If we find that Seven's in small little bits tomorrow, you'll know who to go and talk to. We'll post Warwick's address on the internet. Take it from there. So Seven, great job. Now let's see what's happening in the race. Quite a short little finish line as we often get here. There's the finish line, Ripple Side lined up with the checkered flag, that white cruise in the background. That's actually owned by John Winning. He will have some of his sponsors out today enjoying the day on Sydney Harbour.
Thurlow Fisher
have made a massive play to come up into this group. We said Thurlow Fisher went hard right, dicing with the Russian fishing boat, and it's paid for them. They're in this fight. Mojo just had to duck. We know Mojo did those turns at the bottom, Mark, but they were a long way ahead of Thurlow Fisher all the same. So there's nothing between Thurlow Fisher and Mojo. There's not much between Appliances, but Appliances have overtaken DeLonghi. DeLonghi were second round that bottom, Mark. You remember, Appliances have overtaken DeLonghi. Lots of place changes up in this tricky, shifty, last final beat of this race course.
Always going to be.
Absolutely, and Warwick's just telling us also, look out for Asker. Asker come up in this group as well. Asker right up the backside of Mojo too. Nothing between those two. It's all happening, and I've seen Yamaha are coming in on Port Leyline just to our right. It's all happening. We're beautifully positioned here.
Where did they come from?
Here comes Appliances Online. Here comes Appliances Online. They're going to be next. I think we're good where we are, Bob. We don't want to drift any farther to leeward of where we are now. There goes Appliances Online. They're going to cross. Great job by Mika on the last leg. And Simon Nern. Is Simon Nern going to get to third? Here comes Yamaha on Port Leyline. Come out of I don't know where. But it's all happening. DeLonghi are going to make third. Simon Nern's DeLonghi team.
Well,
cross the line in third. Great job by Simon. Well done, DeLonghi. Well done to today's sponsor. Great to see them getting a result in. Yamaha, where have they come from? Damien McDermott, the light air supremo, even with a small rig. He's come out of the clouds to go around fourth. Awesome result. So Michael Coxon, he'll be pretty happy with what ends up being a fifth. Asco on starboard are going to block out Mojo. This is a close finish for sixth. Asco tax. Can Mojo go around the outside of them? I think they might.
No,
not just a bit too much of a blocker. Asco, they've come out of nowhere as well. Chris Nicholson will be the most disappointed man out of this group. Chris looked like he sailed an outstanding race today. We saw him doing some great overtaking. He's looked quick, but just a couple of mistakes, a couple of things not going his way. I think he will be one frustrated future Volvo skipper.
Put his foot in the touch,
yeah, well, hopefully he's a Volvo skipper, but yeah, that's tough.
That is tough. That hurts, doesn't it? He hasn't really done a huge amount wrong, but, you know, there's little errors. A decently big error to run into the boat in front of you, to be fair. That is quite a big error. And that cost him, ultimately, that kind of threw away his momentum. And he was on the back foot on this beat and never quite got his head into the whole thing. That's what happens at top-level competition. And next across the line, definitely a better performance from David Witt on Sydney City Marine. But I think in these lighter and tricky conditions, I think just having a heavier crew weight, it actually cost. We're definitely at the bottom end of small rigs all today, and Sydney City Marine are at the heavier end of the crew weights, and you just can't argue with horsepower versus weight.
Yeah, and it's the first time he's, I think Mothy had a go at him, at the, just as they're leaving the beach going, what, you've lost it, not manning up today, mate. Normally it would have been in big rig.
Interesting, isn't it? But none of the biggest really show today. You know, I made a very confident and wholly incorrect call that the big rigs were going to have the all the results today, but that didn't work out. There were only three of them, admittedly, so proportionally it was going to be tricky, but none of them really looked that threatening, did they, Warwick? So probably the small rigs, again, were the right choice.
Ian was saying to you guys before the start, if there's enough pressure, they're just really efficient, and we've got pretty flat water in these, you know, southerly courses.
Yep.
So look at how the rest of the fleet is coming in. They're gone right around there. So they've almost gone to Shark Island to come up that hard side of the beat. nobody's coming from the south anymore.
No, the left has proved to be, it's funny, because Michael Coxon did quite well by going hard right, yeah. But all the rest of the guys went hard left. Maybe, again, you had to be hard to a side. Very few people went hard right. Cocker did it, and it worked for him, but David McDermott on Yamaha, I mean, we hadn't even been talking about him, he was so far back, he made a massive gain, massive left shift with pressure. That's actually how he did what he did. Anyone who's looking at the tracker system, if that's working accurately, will have had a chance to see that. Anyway, next across the line at C-Tech. Decent day for Alex Bailings. He was in all sorts of trouble on the start line, looking pretty ugly, but a great recovery from him. Never quite got up into the leading group, but on a tricky day, that probably will end up being a counter for him. Next across the line, Pure Blonde. We haven't mentioned them too much today. Haven't really seen them today.
Cooper's rag.
They're rag and famish.
Woody's going to get the Masters.
Wow, we were saying that that Harry Hamlin was easily leading the Master Championship, but that's all changed around. Pure Blonde go across the line, followed by Rag and Famish. Then it's going to be Smeg. It's going to be a tight battle between Smeg and the Yandu. The Yandu being sold by John Winning. That's the same John Winning of Winning Appliances. So he is a series sponsor, supporter, as well as being the guy, the brains and the muscle and the action behind the whole of this 18-foot skiff club here in Double Bay.
Howie.
And he has still got what it takes to sell a skiff, being no doubt about that. John Winning had a horrible accident. Was it last year or the year before, Bob? I can't remember when it was. He had a major crash in a skiff.
I think it was last year. They capsized the street hand, fell on him.
He did. He was in all sorts of trouble, but look at him. He's bounced right back, and Harry Hamlin getting the better of him so far this series, but not today.
Here comes Harry now.
John Winning finds a way through, so he's our leading master today. We'll check the overall results tomorrow and tell you how the master series is going. But today, John Winning just by one place, pips ahead of Harry Hamlin on CST Composites. Harry from Southern California, come from San Francisco, travels a lot of miles to sell skiffs all over the world. Doing a nice job today. He goes around, but one behind his, I'd like to call him his arch enemy, John Winning, but I think actually they're the best of mates. So.
Yeah, they are.
He's the first big rig.
First big rig, quite right, Warwick. Here he comes. It's the GB boat, Hire Appliances. They go over the line next, followed by the Kitchen Maker, and very soon is Pika, the next of the big rigs. Big rigs staying in close company today. Grant Rollison's, Fisher and Paykel, haven't talked about them much today. Haven't seen them.
On the radar at all.
No, they're absolutely right. They were not on the radar. Anyway, there they go. They're across next. Followed by Pika, and that's pretty much...
Well, there's a few left there, but...
The business end of the fleet.
Ashore.
I think we'll get ashore, and we'll get a few interviews. We've got a few people to talk to. Lots of action today to discuss.
Play of the day, Simon Nairn. And his bowman for falling in the tide.
Indeed. Great job by DeLonghi today. And seven of another very impressive performance for the overall series. Some great racing at the front of the fleet. Some unforced errors, which we got on camera, all very well detailed. Shows what happens at the front of a competitive fleet. Even the best sailors feel the pressure. But we're going to get ashore to do our interviews, whilst the sailors are still keen to talk to us. They weren't very keen yesterday, Bob, to interview, but there was a massive electrical storm, and they wanted to de-rig their boats. We wanted to talk to them, and it was an interesting battle we had. Nick had to use all her persuasive skills to drag the sailors away from the de-rig competition.
Yeah, come and get in
and join us.
Under a tree while the lightning
flashes. Yes, join us, surrounded by metal.
Well, you know what else happens tonight? Because we've got the Lade squared away now, all the guys will head across to the Rag and Famish Hotel over in North Sydney for a major piss-up, so that's all worked out.
That is for sure what's going to happen. It's an honourable tradition in the skiff class to do that, to support one of the best pub hotels in Sydney, and most of the fleet will be there.
Yeah, Peter Kligris will be mine host over there.
And tomorrow, of course, is our day off, so this is a break for us. It's a break for you viewers at home as well, wherever you're watching this from. If you're missing your skiff action, need your fix, there's a whole archive of the JJ Giltinan so far up on the website. There's a highlight video from every day. I think we've got them all up there now, so if you want to watch a quick snippet.
We might be able to get the invitation race up, Nick.
Yeah, maybe.
Yeah, the invitation, it's the practice race, which was lost from your screens for technical reasons. We found it up in the Ethernet there somewhere. It's out. out and found and put back in its box, and it's going to have a label on it, and if you want to look at that, you can. But at any other races you want to look at, if you want to check out the form, if you want to have a bit more information for Pick the Podium, well, go to the website, it's all there. I'm sure there will be a bit of chat on Facebook and Twitter in the next day or two to see what's happening, everybody expressing their views and opinions.
Yeah.
So it's a day off. We're back racing Saturday, local time. It's an hour later on Saturday because of the extra traffic on the harbour. So local time, it's a 4 p.m. start. We'll be live from 3:30 on Saturday, local time, Australia. Check on worldclock.com if you want to make sure what time of the day that is wherever you're, wherever you live. Make sure you get your timing right if you want to watch us live. You can, of course, always watch what we're doing recorded. The recorded version goes up almost instantly the minute this camera gets shut down. The live stream is up within a matter of moments.
And Mark, I spoke to Graham Catley. I said I'd like to have a chat to him about if he can explain to us and all the viewers what the situation is with his efforts to crank up that Kiwi 18-footer fleet over there, and that should be quite interesting. He's put a lot of effort and money in to ramp that up, and we've seen the development in the boats that they've brought across. They're way up there with the Sydney fleet, so something's good going on there. So we'll have a chat to Graham and hopefully get the inside scoop. And the other thing we're going to do on Saturday is a few people have contacted us and said that they want to know what's going on board the camera cat, so we'll bring the camera onto the boat and show you how all the kit works. Not a lot of it, it's quite nifty, but we'll show you how the camera cat is set up on Saturday on a little piece. We might even start the interview, the intro on the camera cat, talking about that. We'll position on, anyway, we'll think about that, but you'll get a look on Saturday.
See what the weather's like. Yeah, that sounds a great idea, actually. Just show you what goes on, how this live stream stuff works. But for now, we're going to moor up the boat. We're just coming up the dock right now, and we are going to briefly switch off live stream. We'll set up in the park, as we usually do for interviews. We'll get them lined up as fast as we can. That will be 5 minutes is the quickest we'll be. 10 minutes is the slowest, the usual deal. We'll come back to you as soon as we can. Join us in a few moments back here on Sydney Harbour for our wrap-up interviews for day 5 of the 2014. JJ Giltinan, see you soon. Sydney Harbour. We've got the podium with us. Today's first, second and third. No big surprise about first. We'll get to you, Scott Babbage, in a second. Second place, a bloke called Simon Nern. I haven't known much about him. And second with the end was Mika got it. Yeah, third, Simon Nernford long in the middle. We'll get to each of you in turn. First of all, Mika, you looked quick today, no question. Every time I looked at you, you seemed to be in go mode. What have you done? What have you changed? Because that's not always been the case with you in the last few weeks. What's going on?
No, it is. I think it is the case with our little rig. We're very fast, and every time we put it in, it's easy to get a result as long as you keep clear air and get a good start. So it's fine. Luckily today we had a bit of a bad start. We got bounced out to the right side of the course and around the top mark first, and then from there it's a lot easier to sort of sail within the top pack than it is battling it out.
Just talk to us about the start. Where did you start, and how did the bounce the wrong way or the right way in the end happen?
We started middle to pin, and we went off probably not very good, second row I guess, and then a boat, Asco, came across on starboard, pretty much tacked in our water I guess, but it was a blessing. We were forced to tack and off we went out to the right hand side, picked a glamour right hander and off we went.
And off you went indeed, and you were in attack mode from then onwards, weren't you? Nice work today, mate. Very good indeed. Simon, haven't managed to have a chance to talk to you much. Well, not on camera. I mean, talk to you all the time off camera, obviously. There's plenty to talk about, but on camera. We talked about a lot of things about your performance today. You know, you'll get plenty of chance to look at your sails and your hull if you look at the video version of today. Yeah. One of the things we talked about was very often you said to me how hard it is to be in the middle of the pack and try and bust your way through, and you often say to me, not a lot wrong with our boat speed, but we just can't get to the front. Well, today you did get to the front, courtesy of a nice first leg and then a very good decision on that big tanker, but then you clearly did have the pace to stay with the leaders. You were not just hanging on, you were in amongst it.
Yeah, look, I think a lot of the boats are quick. I've never thought that we're not in the top three because of our boat speed. It's about where you put it and how well you sail it, and you've got to work, you know, especially the forward hand, got to work pretty bloody hard to stay there. I don't think we've ever worried about our boat speed too much, more about our decision-making, I think.
So today, tell me about the good decision-making that happened. I mean, how much of this was all a cunning plan, and how much did a little bit like Mika talked about, got an accidental bounce in a good way? What was your story?
Same thing. Someone came up underneath us, whacked us up at the start, we got bounced out right, That was the biggest favour they could have done us. And then, obviously, the tanker. Everyone else was jibing inside the tanker, and we just thought, well, we'll just stay high. And there's a ferry behind the tanker, and then there was a fast ferry behind the ferry. So you kind of had to commit pretty early, I think, to get across all those three, which is what we went for.
And it felt like a pretty tricky day. It was small rigs for all the front runners, but certainly bottom end of a small rig. Were you hunting for power all day? Was it tricky on board? What was going on?
Yeah, I think we were probably powered up maybe 60% of the time. I don't know what you boys think, but I think that's probably about right. And the rest of the time, you've just got to keep working your height, working your weight, and just trying to keep climbing up there.
Now, being at the front of the fleet, even for the very best guys, it's a pressure moment. We saw Mojo at the last leeward mark running up the back of you, fouling you, doing their turns. A little bit of pressure, bad decision. Now, you guys, you kind of seem to handle that pressure pretty well, apart from one moment upwind. We saw your bowman deciding to take a refreshing swim at one moment. What was going on there?
He just had enough. He just left us. He said, you know, if you can't win the race, I'm out of here. No, it's just, you know, he's in and out. He's high on his wire. He obviously wasn't fully hooked in properly, leant back. Luckily, he had his hand around the Cunningham, which is where it lives in those conditions, and he managed to hang on.
So. That's Kieran Cowan. Luckily, we'll just give him a name check, Kieran Cowan, a swimmer from today. But in the end, it didn't actually matter too much. You hung on, and you came out of that quite nicely.
Yeah, we got to that last top mark in pretty good shape. I think the boys behind got a bit of a puff down the inside of us, so the break we'd made on the beat got eroded a bit, and then it was kind of all the play for the last beat, wasn't it?
Excellent. Well, great job, Simon. Good to see you out at the pointy end. Good day for your sponsors. It was a sponsor's day today, wasn't it? It was a DeLonghi day today, and the Rabbitohs playing rugby league tonight. Good job. Anyway, at the front, Scott, well, all that was going on. You guys, again, not maybe the best start. It was a funny old beat, wasn't it? We saw you in reasonable shape at the left end, then we saw what looked like a big right persistent shift, but somehow you got out of that corner in reasonable shape.
Yeah, we were fine off the line, sort of mid-line start and went left in good pressure. So we had no problems. We just couldn't cross appliances and Thurlow on the way back. But we came back on the lay line on starboard, so we were fine. I think Mika was the only one that could get around in front.
And then the next big thing was that tanker. And that split the fleet in half, didn't it? Was there any doubt in your mind about which... And did you have an option, first of all, to go to the windward side of it, or what was your thinking?
We could have committed to go to windward, yeah. But I think we jived out quite early because we were rolled by Mojo. And then on the way back, we could have gone, but we sort of got pressure and soaked down on the inside.
Well, that little roll by Mojo, we saw it on camera. Obviously, they used the traffic quite well. What was going on there? It's not often that we see your boat, the Seven, get rolled by anyone in any conditions. What do you think was happening there?
Well, they did it twice to us today. They were probably just... They were higher and faster and going to the pressure first, I think. The pressure was coming in from the left where DeLonghi was, so they went for it.
Well, that was what happened there, but of course you recovered from that and you were being attacked on all sides, but kept your composure. Nice result in the end. That's four bullets for you guys. Hopefully you're going to discard that 12th. Things are looking quite rosy.
Yeah, it's good. I think we need a point or two on Coco tomorrow and we're done.
Get it locked away. Well, that would be good. It would be very early to be winning a JJ, wouldn't it? But look, great performance today again, Scott, showing that you've got the wheels it takes and the composure in tricky tactical conditions. All three of you, great race today. Now, player of the day, as you know, is our own little onboard decision we make as to who gets what. You get this very fine gill cap. I think it's a cap. What do you call these things, Scott? You wear these all the time. It's a visor, is it? Yeah. And, of course, it goes to DeLonghi for an outstanding performance. I think batting way ahead of average. And, of course, specifically to Kieran for that swim and recovery.
I think it is.
There you go. Player of the day to Simon Nairn and his team. Well done, all three of you. We'll see you, not tomorrow. Tomorrow's a late day. We'll see you guys back on Saturday. Thanks for your time. Yeah. Just waking up in the morning in the B well. Quite honest.